guitars going on. There's, you know, there's a lot of extra color, but basically we've got this new part would be
in the house. Dave Tardif in the house, of course, with Stone. Love to have you guys all in studio. Co-host Cody sits across from me as
What's
always.
Happening? What's happening?
Unofficial, official co-host who usually just calls in from North Carolina. You guys may know his
Sitting
voice.
There in the flesh.
You may know his voice. You now know his crazy looking face with awesome fucking beard. Kyle Milligan.
I apologize ahead of time.
Kyle Milligan. And one more guy, can't fail to mention, he's got the fake claps going on. He's got the
awesome audience behind
bombs
me.
Bombs dropping. Yeah. And what else you got? Dings.
Booyah.
And booyahs. Yeah, all right. St. Diesel. St. Diesel's on the board doing his
thing.
And that's the crew. We got a large crew tonight. Everybody's packed in the studio. Don't even have headphones for everybody or microphones, but that doesn't matter here
on
the Beer 30 Show.
Close.
We have enough beer for everybody.
Yeah.
That's the most important part. That's the most important part. Of course. Tonight it's Avery Brewing Beer out of Boulder, Colorado. We just got back from Denver. We didn't venture out to Boulder. It's only, what, like a half hour out of Denver there?
Yeah, about that.
45 minutes.
Let's introduce, we'll start with Dave. Grab a mic and we'll work our way around to introduce the guests today. Just say hello.
Dave Tardif, hi. Stone Brewing Company.
Yes.
Love you.
Yes.
Peace out.
The soundboard guy's got you. Don't worry.
Christina Roberts, and I am the Los Angeles, Orange County, and Santa Barbara sales rep for Avery Brewing Company.
Avery Brewing Co. All right.
I'm Shag.
Shag.
I handle the mountains for Avery.
Man, you sound like you handle the mountains for Avery. Shag, you look like a Shag. How did that end up being? Like, well, you just got lucky with the name or what?
Maybe after a few of these beers. The
all right. All right. One more guess.
I'm Seth. Seth. The Western Field Sales Manager. Just took on that role. Been with Avery for 5 years.
All right. So we got like the whole Western, you know, crew over here.
Yeah.
Representing here to tell us and bring us all these delicious beers from Avery.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, we have big news. You guys got a brand new brewery open.
Oh, yeah.
We're talking canning lines.
Moving
we're talking GABF winners. We got a lot of stuff to talk about. A lot of delicious beers to drink. I think the first and foremost thing, I'm seeing some empty glasses. That is one rule that we cannot break here on the show. What do you guys want to start with? What do you want to start drinking?
I think we should start with a great classic. We're going to start with Joe's Pilsner.
Joe's Pilsner. So we're going to pass that around. Joe's Pilsner, obviously you guys are canning it. It's part of your year-round line, correct?
Correct.
Year-round line. And what's the ABV on the Pilsner here?
4.7.
Is this super hopped up like everybody else is doing, or is this more traditional Pilsner style?
I'd say it's a hoppy American Pils for sure. I mean, it was kind of a little bit before its time. I would say it's, you know, Victory had the Prima Pils.
Mm-hmm.
Joe's kind of came out, and then, you know, Pivo after that.
Of course.
And kind of filled that middle area, and it was out of production for several months just with our move to the new facility.
Mm-hmm.
But it's back up and running, and Yeah, full-time beer.
I think before we talk about Avery and really get into it, we want to know a little bit about your guys' background and how you got into craft beer, how you got into the industry itself. I think we'll start with Seth and work our way back around. Seth, how did you come to love craft beer and then work in the craft beer industry?
Well, I grew up in Durango, Colorado. Okay. So all the boys from Ska are brothers of mine and homebrew brothers back in the day.
Awesome.
And I worked at a couple little small brew pubs, Carver's Brewing in Durango, waited tables, worked behind the bar. Mm-hmm. Then was selling real estate down there, actually. And
nice.
Damn, slaying and banging property out there.
It was big time, big time.
Durango property, baby.
That's right, yeah. I just had to do one deal a year.
And you were good?
Yeah.
Man, that sounds like a really good job.
So then wanted to get out of real estate, knew I was moving over to the Front Range, and harassed, actually, Dale Katechis at Oscar Blues for a couple years.
Okay.
I was a fly fish, or I am a fly fisherman, so I liked the canned beer thing for, and thought it was unusual at that time because it was kind of brand new to the market. So, harassed Dale, finally got a job there. Was there one of their very first sales guys? Was there for 3 years, and then moved on from there to Avery and been there for five.
Nice. So 5 years you've been working over there for a while.
Yeah.
What drew you to the craft beer industry? Just being around the Ska guys as a young crew and just seeing what they were doing?
Absolutely. I mean, super creative, kind of thinking outside the box, being a lot, you know, artistic in a way, you know, being able to kind of create their own scene, their own, you know, vibe, kind of was attracted to that.
I knew they took home at least one medal this year. I heard their name being called. Yeah, yeah. They did well themselves this year at GABF. How about you, Shag? How did you get into it?
Well, I was a general manager of a restaurant in outside of Breckenridge, Colorado, in the mid-90s, and had some staff that was always working with me on putting better beers on tap. And obviously back in those days, it was kind of New Belgium or Odell's that were kind of the highlights that were available. Worked with a great local distributor and ended up having a quarter-life crisis and decided to go travel around the world. So hit New Zealand, Australia for about a year. And before I left, I told my my best craft beer distributor that if I came back, I wanted to work for him.
Yeah, and you were going to need money really bad.
I was going to need money. luckily, that's how it worked out. I got back. I called him up on that, and he said, yep, no problem. Come on board. So I've been in the business now for probably about 16 years, mostly on the distributor side, supplier side, now with Avery for about 4 years.
Wow. Nice. You know, you guys are some longtime members there. You also just got back from the Great American Beer Festival. You said it's probably, what, your 15th or so?
I think it was my 15th year.
15th?
And you've changed a lot.
Yeah, you must have seen a lot of changes. This was our first year. We had no problems with crowds, which you've always heard about. And you think maybe that huge addition helped out a lot with the Great American Beer Festival this year.
What they did this year is, you know, more breweries. They added 90,000 square feet. So the hall got like a whole nother section to it. And it really made it better for the customer, the user experience. They could walk through where in the past it was over the top crowded and you couldn't get beers if you wanted.
What about when you first started going? Was it that crowded? Was it that popular? Was it a
It used to sell out like week of.
It was a really small festival at that point.
So that 90,000 square feet was probably twice the size it was 15 years ago when I was there, or at least it seemed to be. And it was more domestic, kind of was the highlights at the time, even though it was a craft beer kind of festival. So it has definitely changed over the years for the better.
You know, at the media luncheon, they mentioned that this year every single brewery who met the deadlines was able to go to the GABF, and that was the first time in a long time. I know in the future that's how they want to run it, and you're out there, you're a young brewery, you want to get your name out there. That's a really quick way, awesome way to do it. You can get a boot, just meet the criteria, meet the deadlines. You're in Great American Beer Festival.
Oh, yeah.
It's a pretty awesome thing.
You're going to get 60,000 plus people coming through and trying to sample your beer.
Or trying to remember your beer.
Or trying to remember it. You know what's the great thing now? They have those apps now. So back in the days, they never had the apps for you. And now you can sit there, every beer you taste, you can rate. You can remember it kind of through your apps there. They'll tell you when special tappings are happening, when talks are going down. Really kind of everybody just talked about how well it was set up. Water, bathrooms, food, everything was available. Great American Beer Festival kind of just hit it out of the park this year.
Well organized. Everyone's so friendly. That's what I like about it. Everyone, I mean, of course, Colorado, Denver, you know, up in the sky in the mountains and being a free state. Where everyone can partake. People are a little bit more friendly, naturally, but just in the GABF, as far as brewers, volunteers, reps, everyone's just like, woo, come on, let's eat each other's pretzel necklaces. And like,
you could tell the whole city kind of looks forward to the weekend. They talk about it, the drivers, everybody was like, this is the biggest weekend of the year, even though it wasn't. The town was still pretty empty. It was their biggest weekend of the year, and you could tell the town was excited about it. All the volunteers do it every year. They were pumped up. They're like, this is my 6th year. It's just so much fun. Mm-hmm. You can just, you know, it's a good time for everybody in the town. Beer people just take over the whole fucking city. It's kind of a scene, but, you know, we had fun.
And it's so nice how many events there are outside of GABF. And we were saying,
too many.
Like, we could, you don't even have to go to GABF. A lot of people are like, I didn't get tickets. It's like, just go, and you'll have such a great time in Denver with all the different, you know, releases and parties. And
places like Crooked Stave had a bottle release every day that weekend. All 4 days of the weekend, a new beer came out. You know, you don't see that too often. It's a great place to be.
On a local side for us, I mean, what we tell all of our friends that didn't get tickets to the festival because it sells out so quick now is don't worry about that. Come down for all the special tappings. Go to the great craft beer bars because that's where the fun really is.
And this is the thing. Boulder's a half hour away, and you guys probably have a huge weekend that weekend. Absolutely. You know, it's probably huge because everybody was talking about, oh, Boulder has this, Boulder has this. If you have the time, you better get down there, right?
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, that's our busiest weekend of the year or week of the year. Kind of starts on Tuesday when people start rolling in, and Wednesday really ramps up, and it just goes on and on from there. I mean, we had Raja release party. We had, you know, events throughout. It's really kind of a beer week for us.
Mm-hmm. Did you guys happen to hear about an event that they do, that we do, I should say, every year at Star Bar called Robe One Out?
No. Robe One Out, huh? All right.
That sounds pretty intriguing.
Tell us a little bit about that one.
Well, let me tell you about it, gentlemen.
Yes, please do, Christina.
So I did not get a chance to go this year, but I went last year. And let me tell you, it was a fun event with all of our colleagues, and we basically wore these long robes. We had our embroidered A on it, and it was our hardcore softcore event. So where we basically brought our hardcore
it's
beers.
It's just getting better.
Right?
Innuendo all over the place.
Just wait for it. And so what we do is we basically showcase our softcore beers, which would be, you know, the lower ABVs but are still delicious. And then we have our Joes would be a great softcore. And then we have our hardcore beers where you have that stronger ABV, just kind of that, I don't know, Rumpkin. I was going to think, actually, I'm trying to remember. The thing is, I don't remember what we had last year. I wasn't there this year. But I do remember that the robe was amazing. I still have my robe. I still have visions nice. Sometimes of the soft 70s porn that was playing in the background at Star Bar.
And the softcore was
Ottobush.
Animal porn.
Wow. Oh, it was this year?
Oh, no, it was last year.
Last year.
This year was 70s porn.
I thought last year. Well, I saw last year's 70s.
So, you guys go all out with that one. Okay, let's see how it is.
So make sure that next year when you guys come, you reserve your Friday night, because I think it's your
Saturday.
And this
Saturday
is,
night.
This is obviously a family-friendly event, right?
Yeah. Definitely.
Bring the kids.
Are robes provided? Or do you have to provide your own robe? Like my purple silk robe, will that get me in the door?
Absolutely. So a lot of people wear their own robes, or we sell them at the door.
Okay. Nice. All right.
Capitalizing on these.
Now that we have you talking, Christina, tell us about your background, your history in craft beer, and how you got here.
Oh, gosh. How did I get here? 10 years ago, I got into the alcohol industry. Used to sell booze and wine. Mm-hmm. And then stumbled upon a great Belgian brewery called Duvel. So under Duvel USA, I started working with them. It's actually where I met Dave Tardif, because they are still distributed by Stone. So did that for about 5 years. Took a small, weird hiatus as well. Just kind of had a little crisis of like, I don't know if I want to do this. Psych, I do. And so during my graciously lovely months of unemployment, I went to GABF. And yeah. I actually went to Avery for the first time. There were two choices to make. It was either go to Oscar Blues, because we'd spent the day at New Belgium. So mm-hmm. Distance-wise, we had to figure out what's the one place we can go. So I chose Avery. And I just remember walking in probably 20 minutes before they were going to close the bar. And big smiles, welcoming faces, like, gosh, welcome, first time here? Yeah, sit at the bar. We ordered a rumpkin and a momihiwa, came out on a silver platter, and I thought to myself, like, this is amazing. I would love to work for this brewery. And then lo and behold, about a year or so later, opportunity arose. And the rest is history. I got the job and couldn't be happier.
Nice.
Still working with the lovely Dave Tardif.
And that's the end of the fairy tale story, right?
That is.
Yeah. Dave, somebody throw him a set of headphones. Let's talk to Dave for a second here. Dave.
The legendary Dave Tardif. How you doing? Tardif.
I'm absolutely spectacular.
You know, I wouldn't expect anything doing? Less. Yeah. You know, I'm doing okay. I'm kind of hanging. Long weekend.
You're
wedding.
You're looking great, by the way.
Oh, thank you, my
You're
friend.
You're welcome.
Let's hear about your background. Let's hear about your history, man. What got you to Stone Brewing?
Kind of like Shag. You know, I was bartended first, and then ended up being the general manager of an amazing craft beer bar down in Hermosa Beach called Cafe Boogaloo.
Boogaloo?
Steve Roberts opened the place back in 1995, so imagine having 27 handles of 100% craft in 1995.
That's wow. Yeah,
not
awesome.
An easy
wow.
sell.
Yeah, and probably not even that easy to fill up that amount of taps.
Steve actually went and drove to the majority of the breweries to pick up their beer.
Yeah, because, they weren't being distributed this far or whatever, right?
That's right. And that was his passion. So he, you know, hanging out with him for so long, just got the bug and fell in love with craft brew. Had a restaurant in downtown Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, it didn't work out, but I did sell Stone and met Scott Wigand, who was the rep. He said they were looking for help. I needed a job, so it actually worked out perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And here we are.
You said back, was that 98 that restaurant was up?
1995.
Was that a hard sell to some of the customers there? Were people already wanting craft beer at that time? Or was that maybe like a dude who was just into craft beer kind of pushing it on the...
It was a tough sell because, again, you're down in the South Bay, and that's a big Bud Light. You know, they sponsor all the volleyball tournaments and everything like that. So you got a lot of young kind of post-college people that are still in that macro domestic beer drinking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But once they did get to try it out, and we were pretty well-educated staff kind of guided their craft beer journey. But, Stone wasn't even open yet.
Right.
Stone opened
in
1996, so, that's how long ago it was. And Steve Roberts still was the very first Russian River account
in
the South Bay.
So, I didn't know that.
So, Dave, you've been in the game before even your employers were in the game.
Shit. You know, who do you think got them going?
Dave and Shag, like, that was almost like the first era, the first, like, phase of, like, the golden era of craft beer in, like, the modern post-80s,
time.
So, like, how is that different from, like, the 90s? A lot of craft breweries expanded. It kind of contracted towards the late 90s and everything, and now we're seeing this huge explosion. Like, what is that difference between the 90s and now?
I can tell you, for me, back in those days, you had to prove you made great beer before people would bring it on tap.
Yeah.
Now someone opens the door and everyone wants to put it on before they've tried their beer for the first time. Mm-hmm. So that seems to be the biggest difference for me.
I agree. And then now, you know what's even amazing is everything is not just local, it's gone hyper-local.
Yeah.
So, you know, Torrance here has 8 different breweries.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But what we're starting to see, too, is a really good backlash. If you don't make good beer anymore, it doesn't matter if you're right down the street or not, people are pushing back. It's getting back to where the beer is supposed to be. It's supposed to be very well-crafted beer. And unfortunately, some of our local brewers aren't up to par. Some are blowing it away.
Yeah, some came out the gates a lot faster than I thought.
Yeah, and so it's good to see that kind of coming back now, too.
Well, shows like this and, you know, educating. We do lots of staff educations, but
the craft beer drinker these days is, you know, a lot more educated.
And it's just like pressure's on. I hear people, somebody orders a Coors Light at a bar, a guy looks at him like, what the fuck are you doing? Yeah, exactly. Like, and it's that never was the issue a few years ago, you know. People literally are like, what did you just order, dude? Like, come on, look at this list of beers. So you're now hearing people just getting shit for ordering a Bud Light, you know, which I personally love.
Well, also, you know, you got to look at the demographic that's pushing our industry right now. It's the millennials.
Yeah.
So once you get a good taste of great craft beer, you're not going to go backwards into the macro domestic bullshit.
I need some. I need some of that
beer. It's actually in the cooler.
I'll get
Seth,
some in the cooler.
Cooler.
All right, now it's time to talk to Milligan Schwilligan. He's over here huddled around his empty glass. We'll make sure that's not a situation real quick.
I know there's more coming.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about your background and
beginnings.
You know,
not,
well,
don't say it all though, man. Don't say it
don't
all.
Talk to us.
All.
Come on. You know, I know you started
This is broadcast. Sort
of you started as a home brewer in Colorado, correct? And that's
of course we
drink good beer before that, but like when you really got into it, you started home brewing out there in Colorado.
Remember my first experience with awesome craft beer and I'm gonna plug Dave over here for a second and say that the original arrogant bastard.
Okay.
I was 19, and I think we were at Dino's 17th birthday.
That's right.
With a Budweiser keg.
That's right.
And as I'm buying that keg with my 19-year-old fake ID, I saw this thing at the bottom of the cooler, and it was gargoyling at me.
It was an arrogant bastard.
It was an arrogant bastard. I said, I gotta know what that is.
Yeah,
and I got two of them.
Yeah.
And
now you kind of
drinking those in my car.
You kind of look like that gargoyle now.
Yeah.
You kind of resemble the gargoyle these days.
I try to be gargoyle every now and then. It's a good way to be.
But yeah, yeah.
It gets the point across.
Yeah.
And like I remember tapping that Budweiser keg and then remembering I had those beers in my car and I went out and drank one of them sitting in my car.
And then you never drank Budweiser again.
And I never touched it. That's a lie.
No, but it's still, and to this day, that's still one of your all-time favorite beers.
Oh, yeah.
Not just because of the name.
I'm a little bummed they discontinued
it. Of course. Did you gobble up some before it was gone?
I had some good ones, yeah.
All right.
I had one on tap a couple days ago.
So you lived in Colorado. You're a home brewer. You also lived out here in California and just were a beer drinker. How'd you get to North Carolina, which is kind of another beer mecca?
Beer City,
you know, it's kind of crazy. All these
kinda nuts.
Areas just blowing up in craft beer, and you guys have been rated like best craft beer area.
We've been Beer City, USA for 3 years.
Three, you know,
sharing that with Grand Rapids, Michigan, for the last two, I think.
That's pretty.
I could be wrong.
That's
about
pretty
that.
Nice thing. Going.
We're a big part of it.
Yeah, I mean, it's something to do with like breweries per capita or like
I think it's boats.
Swollen livers per beard
like
or
you
something.
You can sit there and click, 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 and then
oh, it's just boats.
City becomes Beer City.
Oh, so
I could be wrong about
they're
that
just
too.
More bored in Asheville. That's all
that might
they
be
have to do is
get a lot of time on their hands. You know,
I know you spent some time with Green Man Brewery, which not a lot of people know out here because we just don't get that
it
much
hasn't made
of the
it
beer out here.
Five states at this point.
But a great brewery, great beers. They
good
do
stuff.
Everything from sours to hoppies to, you know, dark, great stuff. They do everything.
All across the board.
A really great little joint.
Were they at GABF?
We did not see them
no,
there. We did
they
not
were
see
not
them
there.
There. What we did see is Sierra Nevada, and that's where you're working today. Tell us a little bit about that facility I've heard so much about out in North Carolina.
I can say what people are calling it, and that's the easy way to describe it.
Yeah.
It's Disneyland for beer.
Yeah.
It's Willy Wonka of beer.
Yeah.
It's Sierra Nevada. They really turned it on, and it's a beautiful place. It's like you're driving into a kingdom.
Nice.
And you get there, and then you're in the castle. And the back of the castle is my domain at this point. I am the ambassador for a little bit of policing, a little bit of like, you know, keep your kids under control.
Yeah. This is what's on tap.
No smoking. Let's keep this place clean. And
you just get to walk around
talk
a brewery
about the beer,
and get paid.
Talk
that's what
about
you get to do.
Whatever. Just chat with people, and I think that's what I do best. I thought I'd be a brewer, but then I got there and realized I don't know squat compared to these guys. So I just talk.
Do you get a walkie-talkie?
No, earpieces. Just me and my built-in microphone.
How long have you been with them?
2.5 years. No, Sierra Nevada. I was just in since January.
Awesome.
But I've lived in Asheville. I went there kind of hunting a beer career.
Yeah. Awesome.
With in the back of my mind all the big ones. Oscar Blue's there now. New Belgium's there.
It was one of the finalists for Stone before they decided somewhere else.
Richmond.
Yeah. But it was one of the finalists. I know they had a few cities they had narrowed down to. No. Asheville being one. Of course, ended up being Richmond.
They're moving that way. Nice. Green Flash is coming that way. And
me and Cody will be out there in a couple, 3 weeks, and we'll be able to
do
some Asheville Halloween.
The Beer 30 crew will be in Asheville for...
We'll report our findings.
Yeah. Halloween 2015.
You guys are going to
Asheville for Halloween. Yeah. We're leaving our pants back in California. We're going out to North Carolina.
Pants
at home.
What is that?
Because that qualifies as a costume.
What does that
during
mean?
Halloween. That's the thing.
What does
that mean?
Okay. Well, they lost me on that one.
What? You know?
I've known these guys for like 16 years and they lost me on that
Sponge,
one.
SpongeBob, no pants. You know what we're talking about.
.com.
I just got some of this Pilsner and I see a lot of people are already done with it. Let's start the beard reading. Did you take any notes or you remember what you thought about that Pilsner?
I will take my notes.
Please tell me what you thought about
it. We started off with Joe's Pilsner coming in at 4.7%. And you know, this ain't your grandma's pills.
It ain't your grandpa's.
Or your grandpa's, but my grandma, you know, she drank more pills than anybody. pours a nice clear straw, color, you know, single finger head. Good hop aroma with that kind of traditional pills aroma. Smooth, clean flavor. Does have a pretty moderate kind of towards the higher bitterness, good bitterness for a pills. Nice, easy drinking beer with a real hop presence. I'm going to give it a solid 3.5 beards within this style.
Straight
out
the gate, 3.5? That's
nice for myself, I'm not necessarily a big pills drinker. It is an easy drinking, nice beer. It would probably be lower if I was rating it towards my favorites, but in terms of the style, I'd say four beards. It's 3.5 easy.
Nice.
I see you have already moved on to the next beard.
Out of four beards.
What did you think about the first one?
I'm going to give it 3.5. I'm not necessarily a lager guy, but you know, you're in the beer industry. You got to know everything and taste everything.
Yeah.
So
3.5
is a very good lager.
Yeah, that's a nice high rating
as I
right
knew
there.
It would be.
Dave, you did any of that beer over there?
I'm a big fan of the Joe's Pils. I like a Pilsner that has a little bit more of a hop character to it, and this one does. Really good aroma on it, and kind of agree with everybody so far, right around 3.5.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Christina, you know the beard rating system, and of course you can...
I want a full beard, because what I love about this Pilsner is, again, it gives you a little bit of that nice hoppy bite. And for us in the market where there are other Pilsners that kind of take precedence, this one just kind of gives you a little bit of an edge. So if you if you're naturally drawn to those other Pilsners, this is a really nice gradual step up into understanding like what other, you know, great craft beers can produce. So.
Absolutely.
Full
beers. Four full beers. Shaq?
So, you know, I love this beer. I think it's a sleeper beer for us.
Yeah.
It's one of these styles that we don't have a focus on per se. But it's one that sells well for us, for people that are looking for that kind of style. You know, it's an easy drinking beer with that hoppiness to it. I'm going to go 3.75.
Oh, yeah.
3.75. What do you got, Seth?
Oh, I think it's a four full beard.
Yeah, easy.
Category. Or weight rating. I mean, this beer was set out to do exactly what it's doing. It's Adam Avery has always been a climber. He's gone to Rifle, Colorado a lot. Used to load his old rusty Saab up with beer in the back, just load it up with ice and take beers to his climbing buddies.
Nice.
He wanted a sessionable, hoppy beer that was easy to drink, that he could crush a bunch and still be able to climb that day.
Right.
And it's providing that for our lineup.
Yeah, you know, there goes a lot to be said for what a brewer wanted to achieve. It matters a lot what we think about it because we buy it and we drink it.
Exactly.
But if it hits exactly what the brewer has wanted to make it hit, it's, you know, it's a four beer. It is what it is. And that's great when we talk to brewers here, and they'll change our minds all the time on beers. They're like, this is exactly what you're going to taste. And then when we taste all those things, we're like, holy shit, this guy knows why this beer is. And it may not be your favorite, but when he's like, I want this flavor, this flavor, this flavor, and it has all those flavors, he hit it. It's a perfect beer, right, for him and for us. This beer is really good, really crisp.
Really crisp.
Doesn't have any of that twinge that a Pilsner for me that I think about when I think Pilsners. Mm-hmm. Really nice, not overly hoppy, just kind of in there with it. I got some tropical notes I think I picked up on the aroma for sure. 3.6 is what I'll give this beer.
Nice.
These guys know I'm a hater of Pilsner. It's not my favorite. I just don't like Pilsners, but this beer's a really good beer.
See, that to me warms my heart because that's what I love about selling this beer and having somebody taste it. Because I always love, it's kind of like, you can't say you don't like something until you taste it, and then you can have your decision. So forget someone who, it's not your favorite profile of a beer, and all those great nice things. So
yes,
hey, yeah, you add a little hops to anything, and Dino.
Oh, that might be true too. That might be true. Say, and Pilsner's, goes well with hops, and I really love that people are really hopping them up because they complement each other. It really makes it a better beer when you hop it up.
I think it's a smooth Pilsner, very tasty. I like a little hops too. Definitely throw that in there. Like you said, it's described well, so that's also a plus. I'm going to give it a solid 3.6 beers.
3.6 beers. And that's a nice first segment of the show. I think we have a lot more beers to drink. We're going to take a two-song break. We'll be right back right here on dfzradio.com. Call in 562-653-0707. Talk to Avery. Talk to us. We'll be right back.
dfzradio.com.
Sorry.
Thank you. DFZRadio.com.
Tonight's beer selection is brought to you by Stern's Liquor at 4360 East Stern Street, Long Beach, California, 90815, with a huge walk-in fridge and the best craft beer selection in town. Also available in their new location in Bixby Knolls at 4100 Atlantic Avenue, Long Beach, California, 90807. Make sure you check out Stern's Liquor to get your craft.
What's happening? It's the Coderia. You're listening to the Beer 30 Show on DFZRadio.com.
Yeah, we're back.
I was out of being
Kyle, we're back.
Hey, we're back.
What's happening?
DFZVideo.com, Beer 30, live every single Monday. This week's guest, of course, is Avery Brewing Co. I want to thank you all once again for bringing all these beers and bringing yourselves to talk to us, the Beer 30 Show.
Our pleasure.
If you want to talk to these guys, call in 562-653-0707. That's the number. Hoppy T is promising shirts to any caller that calls in. You give him your email address, and he will take care of free shirts for you, dfzradio.com.
He will clothe you in Beer 30 gifts.
You get these sweet Beer 30 shirts, sweet logos. I think we got a couple different colors. Mm-hmm, check it out, 562-653.
If you're a fan of the Denver Broncos, the Clippers, or just multiple colors.
Or beards.
We got all those things.
Yeah, hops, beards, or this show. Yeah, if you're a fan of any of those
things.
Yeah,
get the shirt.
Or free t-shirts. Which most people are really big fans of. We found out that people do anything for a damn t-shirt.
I mean anything, folks. Anything, all right?
We tested it, and we tested it all.
There is a poll.
But I earned it.
we're here, of course, with Avery. And you guys have a brand new facility, and it looks so fresh and so clean. Tell us about that, and what's the difference between this new facility and the last facility you had?
Oh, well, it's either Janky Alley and
wait,
or Taj Mahal.
Don't forget where you came from.
Oh, man. No, we haven't forgotten. We haven't forgotten. But we like drains that work.
Yeah,
and,
that helps.
Yeah,
that
that's helps. Nice. Yeah. I mean, this facility has been in Adam Avery's, you know, mind for quite some time, and it's kind of finally come to fruition. We, you know, we're in an alleyway that was never, the buildings that we were in were never built to be a brewery. I mean, it was warehouse after warehouse that we kind of took over, and I think we ended up in 16 or 17 of them when all was said and done. And you know, it was
happy landlords.
Not an easy tour. You know, you had to take tours and say, "Hey, just peek in this little garage and you know, see what's going on." But
see all that? That's
yeah,
beer.
That's what's happening. Now go have some beer.
Brewing outside.
Yeah, brewing outside, tanks outside. You know, but 22 years of that, or 21 years of that. So we just celebrated our 22nd anniversary in our new home.
Yeah,
it's a 75,000 square foot facility. That's the first phase. It's a 85 barrel brew house or 100 hectoliter brew house.
Okay. Those damn hectoliters.
I know.
That's how Dino measures all his beers in hectoliters.
Nice. And I mean, it's the we're an open book company. So from from a dishwasher on up to Adam Avery, we know exactly what our finances are. And so Adam created this brewery to be an open book brewery. So you come, you can take self-guided tours. Everything's glassed in. You can see everything from our filtration process to our yeast propagation plant to our lab. Look down on everything and see what's going on. It's a really cool facility.
Hey, Seth, did you say a dishwasher at a brewery?
Yeah.
We have a restaurant.
Oh, we have a restaurant now, too.
Oh, damn.
No big deal.
So you're a brew pub these days.
We are a brew pub in a way, in a sense. Yeah, I mean, we have a phenomenal restaurant, phenomenal chef, great food that's paired specifically to our
beers.
You know,
I know that Adam's favorite restaurants is the Bistro at Stone, and kind of wanted to come up with a concept where, you know, it just brought both those things together, food and beer.
Such a good template, that Stone Brewing. It sounds like Sierra Nevada took a lot of that. It's a playground. It's a playground for adults.
It should be. You gotta eat when you're drinking.
Yeah, and you gotta, I guess, chill in a park with like streams and rivers and shit too. Sure. It's nice.
I like how, you know, a lot of brew pubs do this, of course, but then the production breweries with their tap houses and adjacent restaurants are doing this. The idea that craft food goes with craft beer. Yeah. And so just kind of like elevating the quality of everything, and that it kind of all goes together.
You're seeing in this industry such fast growth. You guys talk about how you couldn't even can beers fast enough. And of course, news is today that you have a new canning line that basically just starting today, correct?
Yeah, I mean, it just got commissioned in the last couple of days, and they kind of are now packaging one of our first beers that'll go out to the public. And it's White Rascal's the first beer on that canning line. And
White Rascal 2015 silver.
That's right.
Medal winner at GABF.
Well, not sure if you heard of it.
Well, you know, you're going to be able to. Right.
If you haven't been to any bar ever.
You know, we have a caller in, and might as well get to them. And I think they have something to talk about Great American Beer Festival.
All right.
Pat, are you there?
What's happening?
Hey, Pat. Hey, how's it going? What's up today?
Good. I'm living, surviving each day.
Well, you know, that sounds pretty rough, but let's talk about what beer you have in your hand, because you know the rules. You've called into my show before. You're going to have a beer in your hand when you call this show.
Right now I'm drinking on an IPA Hop Hunter.
Hop Hunter. Whoop, whoop. Hop Hunter, that's the Sierra Nevada. That's the Sierra Nevada, correct?
Yeah,
what are you thinking about that Hop Hunter right now?
Oh, it's one of my go-tos. I love the distilled hop oil.
Yeah, you like a lot of oils, I think.
Yeah, I do like oils. I had the luxuries of trying the I think it's called the Mahara, the IPA.
The Maharaja.
Yeah, that one. Yeah, I knew I'd drop the name.
Is that something you tried out there in Great American Beer Festival?
It is, actually. And then my wife had one of the sours, which I don't remember which one she had. And then...
Would you guys have the peach one out there?
So we had Raspberry Sour, we had Trey Dolia, we had Fortuna. A lot of our one-off barrel-age series, except for Raspberry Sour, which is our year-round.
Yeah,
I know that I got back into line, and I didn't get to get the IPA again. I had to get one of the sours for her. So
you're a good husband.
Smart choice.
Right, yeah, yeah. He knows. He knows best.
But I will give you credit on that booth. I'm a big trade show guy, and I really go after the people that, you know, spend the time to make something more than a 4x8 table and pop it out. And
right.
Your booth was, you know, one of the ones that really caught people's eyes, and I think that's why you guys, not only your great beer, but had a great line in front of it all the time.
You know what I think is awesome?
Thank you.
What I think is awesome too, you guys didn't have volunteers. And
nope.
To me, that's what we did. We searched every single tap handle that had a brewery shirt behind it, you know, instead of those volunteer shirts.
Yeah, we were trained to see the shirts. We were just going down looking at shirts.
And that's who we wanted to see. And you guys, they represent their beer better, you know? It's better than talking to the volunteer. They're just like, I don't know. This one's popular.
Free chicken.
But it's really nice that you guys kept your own crew at your booth the whole weekend, right?
Yeah, the whole weekend. Thank you. Yeah, that's important to us, too, is have an educated person talking about our beers and not some volunteer that knows
Agreed.
It. Even though they're into it, they're having fun, but it's not the best representative for the beer. You guys spend so much time, so much money setting up over there. You might as well, you know, represent your beer in the correct way.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that was a big thing that both caught my wife, and we were there with her brother, and that was something that they both commented on, was that they took notice to, you know, no blue shirt, basically, you know, standing there. And both of them, when they got their beers, had been, you know, detailed into what the beer was about, you know, the different things that were about it and stuff like that, and that goes a long way to the consumer that has to break out their credit card and buy beer.
Hey, well, thank you. Not only do we do that, we have our owner, Adam Avery, who pours the whole session on Thursday and Friday. And he knows that that's what the consumer is looking for. And
yeah.
If they want to talk to you know, the person who's making this beer, who's making these decisions, you know, that's who we are. We don't want those volunteers out there. So we appreciate that that vote of confidence in us.
Yeah. Hey, do you have anything else you want to add, Pat, or talk to these guys about?
Not that I can think of. I'm realizing that it's getting late and I got to make dinner.
I want to know, is your wife nearby? Because I would love to see if she could describe the sour that she had. I'm curious which one she liked.
She works at a bar, and she's a bartender at a place called Beer Envy, and they have 60, it's all it is a bar that serves craft beer, and it's 60 taps.
Wow.
And she's a huge, she has one of them, she's going to kill me for this, Instagram accounts where it's like craft brew babe.
Kill me.
And so she's you know,
looking it up right now.
Yeah, oh, yeah, craft brew babe.
We're gonna get in touch
craft
with her.
Craft brew babe. Yeah.
Oh, we all know about craft brew babe, Pat. Oh yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, that's your wife. Oh, that's your wife.
Shit. I better slow down my DM game.
He's up to like I think it's like 3,200 followers, and they're not paid followers.
Okay. Catching up to the Beer Journey Show. Catching up to the beer, but
yeah, she loves beer though, you know. So it's all and I'll be honest. The Beer 30 Show is what started both of us into craft beer. So.
Awesome.
Cut that sound bite
ding, ding,
out.
Ding.
Replay that all the fucking time.
Sounds good. So it's Brandino, I swear I told you already a few times that you described the beer, and I was like, my wife and I didn't drink beer, and I was like, man, that beer sounds damn fucking good. And I think I'm going to go home and I'm going to find that beer. And I went and I found it and was like, shit. There's such thing as good beer.
Yeah, right.
Damn.
Thanks to Dino, right? Yeah.
Oh, don't kid.
Welcome aboard, buddy.
The Reverend has spoken.
Hail to the now. To the now, now, now. We're gonna talk to you later, Pat. I want to thank you once again for calling in. Tell us about your Great American Beer Festival. Avery.
Thanks for stopping by our booth, man.
Yeah, of course. Best of luck to all the success in the future.
Thank you.
All right. We'll see you later, Pat.
All right, man. Have a good night.
All right, that's how it's done. If you want to call in just like Pat did, 562-653-0707. Tell us a story about your old school beer war, your Great American Beer Festival, or ask these guys a question, whatever you want to do. Hoppy T has promised free t-shirts, so call in, 562-653-0707.
You know you need a t-shirt.
I need more beer. I'm seeing
you do.
My glass is empty. We're drinking the brown. What is this one called?
We were going to actually go into the Ellie's Brown Ale.
Okay, Ellie's Brown Ale. Tell us a little bit about Ellie's.
I love this beer, you guys. This beer is so dang good. What I love leading in with is the picture of this beautiful chocolate lab. And this chocolate lab was actually Adam Avery's dog. And her name was Elle. And back in the 90s, some of us females may remember, and it still is around, but there's this magazine that kind of shared the same name, and they felt just a little bit, I don't know, ruffled. So rumor has it they sent Adam a nice little cease and desist letter.
Yeah.
And Adam said, no, I'll just add an apostrophe and an IE, and I'll call it Ellie's. Mm-hmm. And that is how the name became. But again, I think when I personally first thought about brown ales, I just feel like they're a little bit more heavier, more malty, more chocolatey, almost kind of like dessert. And how many times do I really feel like I'm in the mood for dessert?
All the time.
With this beer,
every
all
day.
The time. All the time, anytime, any, like, it just, what I love is it finishes so dry, I guess you can say, but yet you still want to have more on your palate. There's just little hints of malt, little hints of almost like a dusty chocolate. I like to use the term like baker's chocolate because it's a little bit on the bitter side, but yet it still has that weird hint of sweetness. I just think it's beautifully crafted, and it's definitely probably my go-to. All the time.
Oh,
all the time.
500 days a year.
Dessert time, anytime.
Damn, I've been sipping on this for the last 10 minutes, but I just like enjoy it way. Yeah, it just got way better.
What's the alcohol percentage on this one?
It is low, and it's only 5.5%.
It's 5.5%. Nice drinkable beer. I'm getting a bunch of chocolate flavors on this thing. Roasty, nice dry finish, super low malt on it. It does drink really nice, and a brown ale is not done enough in my mind. I was a Newcastle fiend when before, you know, the big explosion of craft beer. I think a lot of us loved that beer back in the days. And
the one and only.
Yeah, right. And this is something that it's more of a mouthful on this one, more thick flavor, just a more balanced beer. If I were to drink a Newcastle today compared to this, I would think it would taste very watery compared to this. It just has a really nice chocolatey, low malt, delicious flavor to it.
Mm-hmm.
Should I just jump into beard ratings?
Drop a beard rating.
And can we also mention that with this beer, there is no food coloring like Newcastle has? Are we allowed to mention that? Please mention that. We don't add food colors to this.
Do you have color changing stars to tell you that the bottle's cold?
Unfortunately, not.
No mountains either.
Come on now. But
we have a cute dog.
And a delicious beer. I think it's a 3-4. That's the number that pops into my mind. That Pilsner is still ringing out to me. I think I liked it. It was delicious. I'm pissed off to say that. No, I'm just joking. But this beer is really good. But I think a 3-4 is just the number that pops into my mind.
Just pops in there. Yeah, I mean, this thing, you know, pours a nice deep brown. There's some chocolate nuttiness in the aroma. You take a sip. There's that, like, a light roasted malt with almost like a soft breadiness. But it does still kind of, not like that big, round, malty sweetness. You know, it's more of like that roasty, bready nuttiness for me. Really smooth. Really good. I'm going to give it a solid 3.6 beards.
0.6 beards. Saint, what are you thinking? Did you get some? No, just a quick no? All right, no beard for Saint. How about you,
You said Newcastle. I was never a Newcastle fan because there was nothing like this. This is something you can drink.
This is everything it
dessert.
Wasn't.
This is dessert. That's a good way to say it.
Dessert.
I might get in trouble, but I would put ice cream in it.
Like a beer float?
I would love that.
How good would that be?
Any kind of ice cream would go great in there.
Sure. A beer rating?
Hell yeah.
I'm going to do 4.
Yeah. Ooh,
hey. I love that.
Whoa.
Watch out. 4 beers.
Watch out.
4 big old burly gargoyle. Hops-filled beards.
4 gargoyle beards.
Who loves
beers.
This brown ale?
The beard has like chocolate stuck in it.
There's
and
chunks.
Like
chocolate
malt.
Did we come up with an extra pair of headphones and microphone?
We did.
Yes, sir.
We got
digging.
Yes, sir.
See, this is what happens. We're just
dreams come true on
so professional
DFC
on
radio.
We're adaptable.
Dave Tardiff over there drinking his beer. I feel like you just took your last sip. What are you thinking about it?
You know what? This is absolutely delicious. Just like everybody's saying, the nice malty, chocolatey, nutty, roasty, motherfucking delicious malt character.
That's a beer.
You know, I was like you, Dino. I was heavy on the Newcastle before I got into the craft.
Right.
Newcastle is, it's We have evolved.
Yeah.
And that's what I like about American Browns. They do have much more of a hop character, and they're a little bit more full body. I'm giving this 3.87925.
That's a perfect beer.
Booyah.
That's 3.78295 written down.
I got that right here. There we go.
Christina?
Hollywood Dave.
Well, I hope with the adoration that I spoke about this beer would then kind of lead into the fact that it will always be a 4 Viking beards.
Oh, the Viking noise.
That's awesome. It's a spectacular beer. It's a home
like
run.
When the wind rolls through it.
The beard itself.
When it hits it just right. When it hits it just right.
Got to be perfect.
All right. Shag?
So, you know, kind of like you guys, Newcastle was kind of my beer back in the early to mid-90s.
Yeah, of course.
And before, you know, craft beer. And this is one of our original beers from 93. I think we started, Seth, what, 94 is this beer for us?
Okay, so it's an old recipe.
It's an old recipe. And Adam just, you know, Browns aren't like they used to be, but for us, it's held around all these years because it's such a good beer. And for me, that maltiness, and it's just kind of like your first time. You always remember your first one, right? And this is kind of your first good craft brown beer. And for me, it's a 3.75 as well.
Nice. I do like it. Seth, what are you thinking?
Nice. I think somebody hinted on kind of that dustiness or I love the earthiness of this beer. I always get like almost soil and dirt, and I love it. And just that dry finish, and yeah, you can just taste all those malt characteristics with that dry finish. And just, yeah, I think this is definitely a 3.8 for me.
3.8? 3.8. Everybody seems to agree this is a very delicious beer. I think a little bit higher rating than the first beer, or is it about to say a little bit higher?
Right now, we got Ellie's Brown Ale and Numero Uno.
That's
number one.
One out of two.
Oh, Saint, yeah.
Binary.
I didn't get any.
Saint didn't get it.
They didn't get none. None of these got. Oh. Yo, Saint loves it. I could tell by the glow in his eyes.
Ain't nothing wrong with it.
What does the Hop Czar have to say, dude?
It's dessert time.
Ain't nothing wrong with it.
We took Saint's mic. That's what happened. I get it. 4 out of 4 beards. Ain't nothing wrong.
Beautiful.
You know, it is that good. That's, you know, I don't fault you for ranking it that high. I think we're gonna take our second break. It's gonna be exactly one song and probably like 10 million bumpers. But we'll be right back. DMZRadio.com. Beer 30 562 653 0707. Still some free shirts out there for grabs.
Heck yeah, we got Avery in the house.
Went to see what could be found beneath the western sun. Colorado, bluebird sky. You can live a mile high. Colorado, bluebird sky. Miles passed behind me with the things that I had done. Left behind. Sky.
DFZRadio.com.
Tonight's beer selection is brought to you by Stern's Liquor at 4360 East Stern Street, Long Beach, California, 90815, with a huge walk-in fridge and the best craft beer selection in town. Also available in their new location in Bixby Knolls at 4100 Atlantic Avenue, Long Beach, California, 90807. Make sure you check out Stern's Liquor to get your craft.
DFZRadio.com.
Yeah. We're sharing some stories and some old hippie stories, I guess.
Yeehaw! I mean, like, do you want some magic mushrooms? And I was like, hold on a second, let me play my bongo. And then Dino was videotaping and was like, don't videotape my face. I'm on the run.
A lot of felons at that show.
And Nas was very popular at the time. But we had fun. DFZRadio.com is what you're listening to. Beer 30 is back with Avery Brewing Co. out of Boulder, Colorado, bringing lots of delicious beverages for us. We've started off with a pils. We moved on to a brown. And now we're drinking what? Like a tropical wheat tart.
It's tropical greatness? And tart.
We just got transferred to the tropics, man.
Oh, friend. Boy.
Man.
You guys ready to go on a trip?
I got my coconuts in my bag.
You don't bring them with you, man.
I carry those things everywhere.
Tell us a little bit about this beer. And this is maybe the newest edition, correct?
This is our newest addition to our year-round offering, I guess you can say, for lack of better words.
Yeah, that's a good word.
This beer is phenomenal.
What's the name of it?
This name is, everyone, this is a two-for-one. You're going to get to learn a little Hawaiian. So it's Lilikoi Kapolo. And what that translates into is...
Those were the hand motions for Lilikoi Kapolo.
The Lilikoi, Melekelekemaka. So the Lilikoi is a tropical flower that's kind of indicative to those islands. And Kapolo, what does that word mean? Actually,
it translates into passion fruit devil.
It does. It does. All right. Yeah. So it's the passion fruit devil. It's you could say the base of it is basically our Belgian style wit beer. And then we add real Hawaiian passion fruit puree to this. It's added during the secondary fermentation. And what I love about it is that it's this perfect balance of tart, of tang, and then crispness. And again, you don't get, it's not too sweet, it's not too tart, it's not too anything, it's just all kinds of right.
It reminds me
of a Berliner Weiss style beer with that slight tart and super, this has like pineapple flavors. It really has those tropical fruit flavors, but just nice slight tartness to it. Really great tropical flavors to it. The aroma also carries those tropical aromas. Really nice mouthfeel. Everything about it is great. I understand why people like it so much at the brewery. What do you guys think, Cody? What do you think about this beer?
Fuck yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
That's what I said when this thing was poured. We dance around all these tropical fruit flavor and aroma descriptions, but passion fruit is really just driving through there using that puree. I mean, that's more than anything. This is just a nice, bright yellow with that little soft haze of a pour. That tropical fruit comes out of the glass just in your nose right away. Mango, lemon, and, of course, passion fruit. Overall, I mean, this thing is just,
it's nice.
It's hitting all my like bueno synapses right now.
This
it's
is the like most
bing, 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 bing.
This is something that's the most drinkable for me. I could suck down a six pack this style beers. Yeah. No problem. What's the ABV on something like this?
The ABB is ABB, not the ABB. The ABV.
OPP.
It's under 5.5, so it's only 5.4%.
It's another 5.5. So we've had some pretty sessional beers so far.
Extremely sessional.
This one is super drinkable, delicious. my favorite already. I can tell you that.
It's really pronounced aromas and flavors.
Yeah.
It's just really out there.
But also work really well together. Like we had John Palmer on last week. He talked a lot about complexity and balance at the same time. And that's kind of what this beer does have with the tartness, with those tropical notes. Kind of bounces around the tongue. It makes you, whoa. You get pineapple, you get mangoes, you get passion fruit, you get, you know, all those type of flavors, stone fruit flavors. Really, really nice beer. Kyle, what are you thinking?
Sexy.
Sexy.
Very,
right?
Very sexy.
Sexy beer. Let's go into the beer ratings. Kyle, start off, please. Tell me what you, just give it.
Four
Viking
by
beers.
By way of six to midnight.
yeah.
Four beards. You know, four beards are flying out the door today, and hey. I love it.
Four sweaty, thrusting beards.
Whoa! Okay.
Yeah!
That's something I never want to see, but okay.
That's out of four beards, folks. That's a four out of four.
They weigh more at that point.
Dairy eye.
Give it a solid 3.8 beards. you know, not just taking the Belgian wit style and adding a little bit more of a unique and distinguished flavor on top of that, but just hitting my particular flavor.
What you like.
Flavor biases, I guess you can call them. I love this beer, and I look forward to everyone from Avery leaving me all the liliquoy in my personal ice chest.
Did
Thank
he say
you very
that,
much.
Man? God damn. All right.
Thank you. 3.8
That's
beers.
Why we have
very
show.
Delicious beer. And yeah, it's just great. It's all just right. great. I'm going to get stuck on this one,
Saint,
probably.
St. Diesel? Four? Damn, ain't nothing wrong with it. Four out of four beards. You know what? This is turning out to be some kind of beer. Let's go to Dave Tardif.
Yeah, this is a very, very unique beer. I'll tell you, this is for sure a summertime beer, and luckily for us, it's summertime year-round, so this beer is doing really, really well for us. Yeah. I go to the beach all the time. This is always in my cooler. It's just so refreshing. But yeah, with all that tropical fruitiness, this is just a very, very thirst-quenching, delicious. If you're into those tropical fruits and kind of like the industry with the hops, we're all moving in that direction, and this is beautiful. I'm giving it four, guys, just because it set the mark out there for this style of beer.
That's a lot of fours. Yeah, you know, someone who might not be into this beer or that beer, I feel like anyone you put this beer in front of who's skeptical about, like, big craft beer flavors, they're going to enjoy this.
The only thing I think will throw some people off is the tartness, and it hits you right up front, and it's definitely noticeable. So I don't know if everybody would love that tart hit, but I surely do.
I want to ask Dave.
First taste.
I want to ask Dave real quick. He's always hanging out at the beach. Is that Muscle Beach, Dave? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
Just want to clarify for the
and
ladies.
I like that thong little thing you're wearing when you come down. Cody.
Hey, you know. Got to get oiled up.
Christina.
Oh, and you know, and also just for the sour fans out there, you're really going to dig this beer, you know, because it does have that really unique tartness to it.
Yeah, definitely.
What I love is the fact that the majority of the males at the table like this. Because I will say this, I will bring this beer to festivals. And when you want to describe it to somebody, majority of the males be like, oh, I don't, that's not my style. It's
just
like,
give me the hoppiest, most alcohol beer.
Not even that, but there are the majority of the population of the males will be like, that's just not my style. But I like what you even said by the first taste. Yeah, you might be thrown off a little bit and surprised because what you smell is not what you taste. What you smell is all that tropical, like, juiciness. What you taste is just this crazy tartness, but yet it cleans your palate, cuts it, and gets it ready to, like, I want another one.
Yeah.
And
it's refreshing.
It's true. It's just this amazing beer that, and then if you try it for the second time, you don't care for it, then so be it. But I will forever, ever give it four huge beards. Four Viking beards.
Girthy beards.
How about you? How about you, Shaq?
So we got 30 beers on tap at the brewery.
Yeah.
And
that's it, man. Come on.
This is often, if not number one, at least top three beers year-round for us, even though we know this beer is going to sell much more on hot climates and warm days. It sells well for us year-round. And this is not a beer that I thought I would like when we created it
And that's what I've been drinking all summer.
Nice.
Honestly, yeah. I mean, it's not the style at all. So 3.99 is what I'm
thinking. Oh, yeah. 3.99. Nice. That's his highest rating of the night.
Impressive.
Seth.
Yeah, I mean, this beer is just kind of taking off like wildfire, and it's just a special beer. There's no beer like it out there. I mean, there has been other beers with passion fruit, but it's a hint of passion fruit. What I love about us at Avery is that we go full throttle, and it's like, if you want to taste passion fruit, you're going to taste passion fruit.
This is it. Oh,
yeah. This is it. And I mean, it's my go-to for sure. It's my go-to at the tap room, mm-hmm. Especially with the alcohol volume and us mm-hmm. having everything up to 20% beers. This is a nice sessionable that I can keep a level head for from morning till dawn.
Yeah, mm-hmm. it's.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you give a beer ready?
Oh, no, I haven't. Sorry. Yeah, I'll just give it a 4.
A 4? Yeah. Oh, yeah. There yeah. we go. Another 4. And it's like, yeah, it's adult, you know, juice. You know, and it just drinks so nice.
It's juice.
It is juice. And
you can
want
give
more.
It to the kids.
Sure.
Give it to the kids.
Yeah.
Sure. Don't like it.
In Germany, yeah, sure.
You know, my kid digs it.
Great. Yeah.
Dave has always been an advocate of giving the beer to the children.
Educating.
You got to educate the next generation. You know, that's what it's all about.
You know, super delicious beer. You guys said it all with all these great flavors and the perfect tartness to go along with it. Leaves nothing but you wanting more afterwards. Mm-hmm. 3.8.
I'm into it.
It's really, really delicious. Another great beer.
Do we have more of it? I was just wondering. For a friend who's asking.
Do you guys consider Anchorage one of the big breweries, one of the big craft beer breweries?
Just in general?
Do you think you're considered in the industry one of the big guys?
No. No.
I'd say medium.
What is your barrel production? What do you guys produce each year? Well, now that you have a new facility, of course, it's going to be different, but...
So last year we came in, or we're coming in, about 60,000 barrels. I think the new facility, we're about double that. On property, I think we'll be able to expand up to about 400,000 barrels. So this year, we'll probably be in about 70,000 barrels.
Mm-hmm.
Next year, we're looking at maybe pumping it up to 120.
Man, yeah, and with that new cannon line, you guys will be pumping beers out quick.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, and what that new facility is also enables us to do is that we've been barrel aging beers for, yes. you know, a little over 12 years. And I mean, barrel aged beers and sour beers have become really mm-hmm. popular within mm-hmm. the last 2 to 3 years. And, you know, we've been doing it for quite some time. So what it's also enabled us to do is quadruple our barrel age program. Okay. So you're going to start seeing a lot more of those sours and seeing a lot more of those barrel beers out here.
How far are you distributed? Where can we find your beers? I know here for us, no problem. But other places, how far do you guys go?
Well, we're in 26 states. I would say consistently sending to about 13 of those states.
Okay.
Both East Coast, West Coast, the Southeast. We have reps. We send the most beer currently. So we have a rep based in New York, 2 here in California, 2 in Southern California, Chicago rep, a Texas rep, 6 in Colorado, and DC. In D.C.
It's probably like a beer finder or something on your website.
Absolutely.
You can find out where all the beers are. You talked about anniversary. You guys just celebrate anniversary. Mm-hmm. Anniversary beer coming out.
22.
We're going to get some here in Southern California, but it's not going to be that easy to find.
No, it's not.
It's not going to be going everywhere either.
No, it's not.
So we're lucky enough to get some here. What's that beer? Can you guys tell people what it's going to be?
Yeah, it's actually it's 100% Breaded Amices beer. It's mm-hmm. actually the first one that we've done since the 15th anniversary.
Okay.
Dry hopped, and we use lemon drop and And I just spaced.
I was trying to remember too.
Lemon drop hops.
It's lemon drop, and I actually want to say it's Hirschbreckers because that's the same because that's the same hop that's used in our Joes.
Yeah.
And so it's those two. And it's gosh, that beer is so good. I got a chance to try it a couple months ago. We are very fortunate. Talking about what states that, you know, we are distributed through, mm-hmm. Outside of Colorado, Southern California, solely due to Stone distributing, we're number 2 for Avery. Oh. So Colorado first, us second.
That's and, right. California.
So we're looking to get a nice little handful of some cases.
I can almost guarantee you Stern's Liquor is going to get a couple. I don't know who represents them, but they usually get whatever they want.
Stern's is absolutely a long-standing good account for, I think, many the craft beer.
Yeah.
Stern's, you will be able to find it at Stern's.
Yeah, Stern's Liquor, our sponsor. We want to thank you for supplying us with beers to drink Stern's. Every single week.
It's and funky, hoppy, and wild.
That's funky, hoppy, and wild.
That's our 22 anniversary.
100% Brettanomyces.
Steel fermented.
Just to give you the side of distribution, it's going to go out all through Southern California.
Yes, sir.
To the border, Inland Empire, Ventura County. We're going to be sending this stuff all to just the really good Avery accounts and really good craft beer bars.
Mm-hmm. So keep your eye out. Of course, follow these guys on Instagram, Facebook, and all that. And I'm sure you'll learn more about it. But the anniversary beer is always something to look forward to, especially for me, the Brettanomyces style beers.
Right.
Love them.
How many cases did they set aside for you?
Well, you know, that's we keep that. That's back. That that's green room information.
Dina.
has everybody ranked this beer?
Yes,
we've ranked this beer. Let's drink another beer. Let's do that.
Let's drink another beer.
What do you have here?
I think it's time to go back to.
I think we're going to do IPA now.
Oh, that's where I was going, John. Yes. I think it's time to go back to the OG of Colorado.
Yeah. Oh, shoot. Let's talk about it.
Is it not a true fact that this was the first IPA that was ever canned in Colorado?
Oh.
Bottled or packaged? 1996. Oh, yeah. I was a junior in high school. Where were you in 1996?
1996. Man, that was a crazy year, man.
I was a freshman.
Right?
I was actually in Fiji.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Actually going from Alaska to Fiji. That was great.
I was ditching Spanish class in freshman year and just... That's about it.
I dig it.
Man, I was putting liquid acid on Doritos, man.
We can tell.
Check.
Two for five.
Where were you in 1996?
There you go. He even knows the prices, man.
Yeah. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. Hey, this ain't Shag's first fucking rodeo, motherfucker.
That's good. So this is the IPA, straight out of Boulder. You know, I noticed... Cody, I don't think cared as much as I did, but a lot of breweries really doing hoppy beers out in Denver. We went to about 6-7 breweries, and that was maybe a far afterthought for a lot of these breweries, which a lot of them here are doing the exact opposite, trying to produce the biggest, baddest, hoppiest beer there ever was. Do you guys notice that in Boulder? Is that a theme in Colorado? Just big IPAs are not that important?
Oh no! I mean, they're definitely important. I mean, I think that the interesting thing that we've seen is it's not necessarily the weightlifting contest that it used to be.
Yeah.
And you know, we're seeing more complex and more hop forward beers, more West Coast style IPAs.
Yeah, of course.
Just saying.
Just because they're way better.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, where that malt forward IPA or more balanced IPA, came into. But, was kind of the original IPA.
Yeah, of course, of course.
Less weight lift, more complex, drier finishing beers.
Yeah, for sure. It just is something I was finding myself really searching for, I guess, a true West Coast style beer, and I just couldn't find one.
There was a few times where people would recommend us.
Yeah.
Try this one, knowing, and,
maybe I was being a little, but once we got to Great American Beer Fest, of course, there was way too many hops to be drank.
Oh, yeah.
And I had my fill. But I just wanted to ask you guys, because you guys are hometown Boulder, there's this definitely a style out here. Breweries want to make the biggest, baddest, hoppiest beers. Most of them do. Of course, there's places like Monkish who could care less about that. Brewery could care less about that. But I just noticed a trend in the breweries that we went to that they could care less about impressing you with a hobby beer. They were going to make sure they had a well-rounded lineup with kind of true to style. Mostly everything was very true to style.
Seemed like that's really coming out strong now. A lot of just traditional styles and people really
instead of fucking with them so much to become their own, but really producing a traditional style and doing it well.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we found when we hopping around. This beer is... Is it another really old recipe?
Well, I mean, it's a recipe that's changed over the time. I mean, at Avery,
it's
been
tweaked.
We never kind of rest on our laurels, and we're always changing our recipes all the time to, you know, make it for how Adam Avery actually wants it to taste. This beer actually is closest to what Adam's always wanted it to be, and that comes from our new facility. Our new facility is the extraction rate that our new Krohn's Steinecker brew house is enabling us to get to is, you know, creating a drier finishing, more hop forward IPA, and it's kind of what we've been looking for. But it was things that we couldn't do on our old system. Mm-hmm. This beer, when we just said when we it was one of the first beers we brewed on the new system. We said, okay, we're just gonna brew it like our regular recipe and see how it goes. It came in at 200 IBUs.
Oh shit!
So that that'll
so explain
like
that
your ex-wife.
Normally it's 69.
Right. So explain that a little bit though. Were we talking about hop utilization?
Absolutely. So it's it's utilizing those that hop, extracting those hop flavors way more, extracting those oils way more than our old system could. So we obviously had to tweak.
That's very interesting.
Lower the hops and everything. Is that just the temperature control? Is that just the
the efficiency of that system? I mean, it's leaps and bounds. That our original 40 barrel system was, you know, we had for 16-17 years, and then we started out with that original 7 barrel and then moved into that. But
sounds like there's going to be a learning curve for the brewers there. It sounds like they're going to have to learn how to brew on the new system.
For sure, and they have. You know, we've been open since February, and there were some tweaks and lots of different things that we've
sounds
done.
Like it,
But I would say that every beer that's coming out of that new facility is exactly how we've always kind of wanted it to taste, and maybe we couldn't tweak it enough to get it to where we wanted
and
to.
And we haven't mentioned yet how fresh these beers do taste. They taste fresh. They taste clean.
Nice.
This one especially.
They are fresh.
Really low malt, which I do love. Loaded almost no malt on this one. Of not overly hoppy. People are, I find, more and more turned off by a lot of hops, which I'm not, but this one is super balanced. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not going to kill you with that hops, but it's just really nice. Refreshing for an IPA, you know what I mean? A lot of times IPAs are bitter and dry. This thing is refreshing and delicious.
Super sessionable.
Super sessionable. What's the alcohol percentage on this?
6.5
Six. So it's nice. It's on the lower end for an IPA, right?
Yep.
Cody, do you think you got any thoughts on this one?
Yes. This thing just is nice. I mean, this is. I see what you're saying in terms of it's like big hop aroma and dried out, but just enough, and not in that sense of like it's a novelty act. Pours a nice clean yellow, just a really clean citrus hop aroma, good bitterness, big citrus flavor, but it just kind of comes through, finishes dry, really clean drinking beer, totally refreshing at 6.5%. I think it's in the West Coast style, but not overdone. I'm going to give it a 3.75 beards.
I got one more question. Do you have any more of it that I can drink? See, we're going through the beards here pretty quick. Kyle.
This brings it back. I haven't had one for a little while, and this was one of my favorites in Colorado, as are you guys. I feel like you were talking about, you mentioned capacity-wise, who's the biggest out there.
Yeah,
I think it shouldn't matter capacity.
But
that level, but as far as along across the board and great beer, I'd say you guys are like top three.
You know what?
Killer. It's been one of my favorites out there.
You know
there.
Why I brought that up, Kyle, is because, like you said, Dave, they've become so local drinking. Even the bigger craft beer breweries get a bad rap. Like they're like, oh, they just sell so much beer, it can't be good. And it's like, what? Like, what does that even mean? Like, you know, like you got to take a step back, taste the beer for yourself. Mm-hmm. Don't listen to the hype. Don't listen to whatever it is, and fucking drink a beer for yourself.
Oh, yeah.
But I feel like bigger breweries get a bad rap just for being a bigger brewery. Mm-hmm. And people are just getting in the crab bay and they're like, oh, yeah, this place right down the street makes better beer than Stone. And you're like, no, they really don't. But, you know, I'm sure they make good beer.
Yeah, you got to evaluate all aspects. So, side note, to follow up on what Kyle said, you know, there was a time a few years ago when Kyle was in between Colorado and North Carolina, 5 or 6 years ago.
Living on your couch or what?
Yeah, he was living in my house on and off. And we were like, you know, like painting the walls and ceilings and stuff like that.
Sober.
And he was painting this big red A on all my shit. And I was like, he's like, this is my favorite brewery. Yeah. Oh, let's eat some mushrooms. Ah. And I'm like, what's this big red A all over my shit? You an angel fan? And he's like, Avery Brewing, bro. Sure Avery Brewing.
Down to the.
So I'm just. The depth of
and everything.
Fandom is deep here. Yeah. So
yeah, I forgot I about that. I love every bit of it. I forgot about
We're
that.
We're gonna be hiring in North Carolina soon.
There you go.
This is true.
He will double back. You know, you'll get off one job, go to the other.
No comment.
Tardif.
Wait, did Kyle actually give a number?
I'm going to go 4. That's
far bad. You know, he is a fine for a job.
I think this is. they've already broken the record for
it is a four
beers, right? They've already.
This is the most fours on any broadcast of over. Yes, you can check the archives at dfcradio.com. We've done over 2,000 ratings probably at this point. And this is the most fours we've ever done.
You know, I know that you guys archive all of your podcasts, so yeah. I'm going to go on the radio, or I'm sorry, the website, to find the archives on the radio.
Good sound bites from this one.
We'll see, but I appreciate that.
All the fours.
More fours? That's humbling. I really appreciate that.
This is
you earned it.
I'm talking about the panel too, not just you guys. Of course, you guys throw it out for us, but the panel seems to be loving the beer tonight.
Mm-hmm.
At Dave Tardif.
Yes, this is a very refreshing IPA.
Yeah.
This is, I think, for people that are wanting to really start getting into the IPA world.
Yeah.
This is a good one to start with. The lower ABV, 6.5, really good. You know, citrusy, kind of piney. To me, and it does have a nice bitter assertion to it, and it lingers, you know, it's nice. And it's only, what, 69 IBUs?
69, yep.
Yeah, so, you know, you're getting right up into that threshold, but very, very easy drinking IPA. I'm going to give this a 3.7.
3.7?
3.7, babe!
Love it. Christina?
Yeah, I dig it. What I love, too, is everything that you said, actually. Just it's refreshing. I think us out on the West Coast, we're really used to a certain style, and we kind of expect certain things. So I definitely like that when people do get to try it, it's kind of like the dark horse in the race.
Okay.
So it easily is, for me, I'm actually going to go down a little bit. I'm going to say it's a 3.6.
3.6?
But it's still, it's just pleasant. You should try it.
3.6.
Try it. Try it.
Listen to her.
That's a very nice.
Hear her. Listen to her.
Yeah.
Shag, what do you think?
So here's a funny story on IPA. We were the first to package this in Colorado in 1996. And back then, people were sending it back. Like, this beer's too hoppy. It's too bitter. Something's wrong with it. It's spoiled. Now our palates have changed since 96. And now it's more sessionable beer at 6.5. So I'm going to give this beer a 3.75.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the way people hammer hops into beers now is nothing. It is crazy compared to what you had back then. How about you, Seth?
I drink this beer every day. It's my job to drink this beer. And,
sweet job.
I get paid to drink this beer. Exactly. I pour it on my cereal every morning.
That's right. you know, and the way that it's changed over the years is I've loved, and it's gone every direction that I've wanted to do. One, I'll say it's a 3.8 for me.
Okay, 3.8.
And, you know, one thing that we feel that we want to go towards is a bigger aroma on this beer, and that the new brewery is going to allow for us to do that. So it's a little tickler that this beer is actually from day one has never been dry hopped.
Okay.
So this
that's actually interesting.
Will
yeah.
eventually surprising. This is in the it's going down the road of being dry hop just for that aroma.
That'll completely change the aroma.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so that's kind of what the next thing that I think that this beer needs, and we're tweaking it, and it's, you know, it's allowing for us to do that.
Sounds like
facility.
The new facility nice. Is allowing you guys that's to do right. a lot of things you wanted
absolutely.
To do.
Mm-hmm.
The press. Yes,
hey, here's
sir.
Another fun fact for you, Dino.
Ooh. Yes, sir.
The packaging. If listen you look up. On the can, they actually show the route that the
oh,
English
on the,
took
on the IPA.
To
yes.
India.
Yes. The map here.
Hence calling it India.
So a quick history lesson on the front of this label right here. Actually cool, very recognizable. Everything you guys do. Do you have a certain artist or somebody you work with? Because all your labels are so recognizable.
That's a great question, do you gentlemen. Know? I don't know.
Yes,
do you?
Don't know there that? Is a certain artist, and
hey, just a question.
Possibly multiple artists.
You guys can't know. You know.
Juan Carl.
It's a secret.
Yeah.
I would say Adam Avery is very much involved with all the packaging, mm-hmm. With mm-hmm. all the artwork. He picks most of the artwork. Works hand in hand with a company called TDA. That's a graphic artist company, a local company in Boulder. There is a neat story real quick about yeah. this IPA, about the map that's on here. Is actually came, there's a map store on Pearl Street, our downtown local walking mall. Yeah. This guy, so backtrack a little bit. We purchased a piece of land for this new facility that was turned out to be next to a private school, private elementary school.
Wow.
But
that doesn't work, right?
Bummer. Brewery's well, like yeah.
Do it for the kids.
Yeah, exactly.
Do it for the kids.
No.
Children, man.
Educate the
children.
That is perfect.
They would start them young.
Yeah. Unfortunately,
really
the school built in an industrial zone, so we kind of had
precedence.
And so, but one of the final votes was on the city council, and the guy that owned this map store that Adam and his dad bought the original map from was on the city council.
He's
and
the
was
deciding
the deciding
vote.
Vote
so that worked
conveniently.
That worked out.
When in doubt, buy a map.
Exactly.
That just tells you how small. Hey. It just tells you how small of a world it is. It's like, yeah, the guy who owns the map shop was the guy. It's like,
of course he's on the city council.
And it tells
he's
you
he's old.
And it tells you how long ago it was, or I mean, map stores. Like,
yeah,
how many people who are drinking age right now are like, "What's a map store?"
Remember the map store we used to go to?
You mean Google?
Triple up on my phone, right?
Triple A, I guess.
That's awesome. But that's nice. Awesome.
I think we're gonna take our third break. We're gonna come back with Brews News right after this break. Beer 30 is what you're listening to right here on DFZRadio.com. Our guests are Avery Brewing Co. out of Boulder, Colorado. And the phone number is 562-653-0707. Stay tuned. It's kind of hard being Snoop D-O-double-G, but I somehow, some way, keep coming up funky-ass shit nearly every single day. Can I kick a little something for the G's? And make a few friends as a breeze through. Don't you know it's 2 in the morning and our party's still jumping? Cause my mama ain't home. I got the bitches in the living room getting it on, and they ain't leaving till 6 in the morning. So what you want to do, ho? I got a pocket full of rubbers and my homeboys do too. My money on my mind. Rolling nice straight, smoking and oh, sipping on gin and juice, laid back. This type of shit hurt me.
later on that night, my homie Doc tried. He came by with a gang of tangerines and a fat ass jay of some bubonic chronic. You know it made me choke. It ain't no joke. I had a bag up off the set my cup of gin down. Don't you know tanker ain't chronic? Well, I'm hooked up now. My money on my mind, 49 straight, smoking and up, sipping on gin and juice, lay back with my mind on my money and my money on my mind.
DFCRadio.com.
Tonight's beer selection is brought to you by Stern's Liquor at 4360 East Stern Street, Long Beach, California, 90815, with a huge walk-in fridge and the best craft beer selection in town. Also available in their new location in Bixby Knolls at 4100 Atlantic Avenue, Long Beach, California, 90807. Make sure you check out Stern's Liquor to get your craft.
Welcome to Brews News. I'm Cody Brewingrow. First up on the headlines, it is now legal to operate beer bikes on city streets in California. That's right, Governor Jerry Brown has signed SB 530 into law. Governor Brown signed the bill while riding a beer bike in Sacramento with his wife and state senator Richard Pan. Senator Pan crafted the bill to create a vehicle safety standard for pedicabs that allow up to 15 people to pedal at once. The law allows passengers on the pedicab to drink the best craft beer available while riding around the city. Beer bike pedicabs are often provided as a riding tour around a city like San Diego, with select stops at bars and brew pubs. Governor Brown has already signed into law bills legalizing beer tasting at local farmers markets. So cheers, Governor Brown. Here's to helping the state with beer-related activities while still looking cool. And now in international beer news, Morocco has canceled its first ever beer festival. That's right, local authorities in Casablanca have shut down plans for a festival of beer. The Moroccan company Brasserie du Maroc organized the event, which was supposed to be held from October 8th to November 8th. The month-long festival was intended to boost sales and promote local bars and beers. Authorities said they banned the festival because of non-compliance with legal rules and procedures. The Muslim country has strict penalties for Muslims caught drinking and tries to limit the advertising and distribution of alcohol. So bummer, Morocco, you almost made it into the worldwide beer movement. Speaking of backwards religious folk, Texas officials have prohibited the use of crowler fillers in the state's brew pubs and bars. If you are not familiar, a crowler is a 32-ounce aluminum can that is used like a growler, in that it is filled at a brew pub for a customer to take home for later. The crowler is fast becoming a favorite among beer fans for its ability to keep a draft beer fresh longer. The state regulators say the problem lies in the fact that retailers need a manufacturing license to operate the can filling machine. The Texas Alcohol Beverage Commission has been stepping up its enforcement game, going so far as to send agents in to seize one of the machines from a bar that was ordered to stop selling the crowlers. The officials' aggressive stance has rubbed bar owners and craft beer lovers the wrong way, with some setting up for a legal fight and others petitioning for a law change. The crowler machines have been sold to beer retailers by Oscar Blues for the past 2 years, with crowlers now available in California and the free state of Colorado. So cheers, Texas! No one wants to move there anyway, so who cares about your stupid beer laws? And now, beer festivals and events from around the world. The 2015 Nottingham Robin Hood Beer Festival is taking place on October 7th to the 10th in the lovely historic Nottingham Castle in Nottingham, England. This event will feature over 1,000 beers and 200 ciders, hot food, cold food, entertainment, and some crazy old dudes. The second annual Haunted Brew Fest is taking place in October 10th in beautiful Colorado Springs, Colorado. This event will feature over 100 beers from over 40 breweries with a costume contest, games, live music, and some pretty scary spiders and ghosts, I heard. The fourth annual Harrison Beer Festival is going down on October 16th and 17th in Harrison Hot Springs, British Columbia. This event will feature a cask night, a live Oktoberfest band, and tons of great Canadian beer. Oh, yeah. And finally, the greatest event of all time. It is Beechwood Brewing's fourth annual Sour Fest, held every other year at both their Seal Beach and Long Beach locations. The event will feature sour beers from local breweries on Tuesday. Crooked Stave will be featured on Wednesday, and the brewery will be featured on Thursday, Allagash on Friday, and the Shelton Brothers will be providing the sours on Saturday. What an epic week of great beers with some 200 different sours being offered at Beechwood. Wherever you are in the world, get out there and join in on your local craft beer events. I'm Cody Bruingro, and this has been another episode of Brews News Weekly Update on the one and only Beer 30 Show on DFZRadio.com. Back to you, Dino, in the studio.
Wow, all right. Nice. Another great edition of Brews News.
That was amazing.
And you were pumped up.
Can I insert breaking news?
Anytime you want to, please do this.
Breaking news on Tuesday, tomorrow, basically. Beechwood is actually tomorrow. Breaking news. Beechwood is actually going to be featuring some rare Avery beers that we were able to submit. So, prior to anybody else getting it, they will be offering Raspberry Sour, which is one of our barrel aged from our botanical and barrel series.
Deliciousness.
Amazingness.
This is going to be at both, or do you know which location?
You know what? I actually want to say it possibly might be at both.
Okay.
It's a gamble. I would say contact Beechwood.
So guess what? It's not a gamble because they have a free shuttle going back
and
forth.
They sure do have a free shuttle. And, it's going to go
and
back.
And so all you got
to
do...
You just show up at one place. Yeah, you can go to both.
Just stumble out of one and stumble back into the other. It's just a great thing. Beechwood knows what they...
Dino is going to a private kickoff event.
Ticketed, private to the ticketed members at the
yet to be opened Beechwood Blendery, Cascade Tap Takeover to kick off Sour Fest.
Yeah, they're doing a couple nice little takeovers. I'm really surprised that they're going to use that tap room before they get any of their other beers in, because I know how Gabe is very picky with his things. I'm surprised, but there is an event that's been going on all day. Cascade, there was the first first session started like this afternoon. Second session was late afternoon. Third session, 9:30 tonight. I'll be there with a couple other people, tasting 12 other Cascade beers.
Nice.
We love Cascade.
Yeah, and I just love I just love sour beers so much. Can't wait for that, but...
But yeah, on Tuesday, Raspberry Sour, and then we also have from our Barrel Age series and bottles, our Fortuna, which is basically our...
Tequila.
The problem with this radio show is it's so great, but then you realize how many beers you've taken. So
I know.
That's what makes it great.
That's what makes it great. That's what makes this show
much less standards.
We just get everybody drunk, and by the end they're like, "This show is cool."
It's wide open.
But our last three barrel aged sours will be available. So we have our Avery Fortuna, our Avery Insula Multis Colibus, which is kind of our take on the classic Manhattan, and then we also have our Tectum Et Elix, which is Latin for roof and drain. So as we started off with this program, Seth talking about one of the great things brewery is having a roof and a drain that works.
Roofs and drains?
Roofs and drains are two things that are kind of...
You guys are really picky. You need a lot of things.
It's just like... So, yeah. It's a good week. It's a good week.
Into the fundamentals.
Right. And this is White Rascal. Which I said before the show. It's the one I see the most. It's the one I hear about the most. I asked if it was the biggest selling beer here on the West Coast. He said...
Nationwide.
So it's the favorite amongst Avery fans. Why do you think it's the favorite?
Approachability. I mean, this beer's a classic. I mean, it's based off of a traditional Belgian wit, but our little take on it is a little bit more coriander, a little more Curacao orange peel.
You get that coriander straight right up front, and it's really nice.
And I mean, an approachable. It's such an approachable beer for, it's great. It's a great gateway beer for the craft beer drinker, but also is really appreciated by, folks that are, more of the beer geek.
Yeah, for sure. What's the ABV on this one?
So 5.4, 5.6.
Yeah. Beer geek. Is that an intermediate, like beer wizard?
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Lots of wands.
We're beer padawans.
Pocket protectors.
The beards are shorter.
We're just young.
Cloak is shorter.
Padawans now. We'll move our way up.
Padawan.
White Rascal, the most recognizable beer with this with Avery for me. Really kind of delicious. It's got that classic, you know, flavor to it. It fits the category to a T. A lot of your beers so far have been outside the box when it comes to fitting a category to a T. I feel like this one fits it mostly. That coriander comes out huge right in the beginning. It kind of goes out into this musty, you know, deliciousness. I'm having a hard time describing the flavors.
It's like
a
herbal spice mixed with lemon. The Belgian yeast really, you know, is definitely prominent. You know, a dominant characteristic, but not too much. It's just, like you said, it's approachable, very drinkable, like all these beers have been, but still has a unique character to it that makes it distinguishable from other Belgian whites. That I guess coriander or orange peel is—it's almost like a little bit of a bite, like that, like a citrus bite. That's what I'm picking up.
Great mouthfeel. Mm-hmm. Okay. Get it kind of in the top, you know, back. And
can't hear myself anymore
because you're not talking into the mic.
I'm right at the mic now.
There you go.
That's good mouthfeel, Mike.
Do you guys? This is. You guys talked about a little bit about your favorite. This is the all-time favorite of, you know, obviously consumers. What do you guys agree with the consumers, or is there something else in the lineup that maybe takes the cake for you?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I mean, I think it just depends on, like, what you're in the mood for.
Of course, each
day. But I like what you said, too, like the mouthfeel. I think why I'll be very candid and honest and transparent, like we should all be.
Right.
This is not my go-to style. I do not care for the Belgian style whipped beers, typically because of that those Belgian esters. It just is almost like eating a bunch of candied runts to me. It's what like that weird banana-y. Okay. Yeah. So sometimes if it's overly done, it just gives me a stomach ache. But what I love about this is it's so well balanced, and there's just enough of everything, and it's really easy to drink. So that's why for me, it's my go-to. I don't know. I'm so pleased and I'm so proud of this beer, and I can see why most people will come back for it. And when we pour it at our festivals, we do have lines and everyone is enjoying it.
I'm right there with you, which it's not my favorite style. Although I feel like this is the style that brought craft beer back. I think there was a resurgence late 90s where Belgian beers just became so popular again and everybody was drinking them. Every craft beer bar that was opening up was Abbey something, and it had Belgian beers, and it that's what I thought brought craft beer back. And it's kind of weird to me that I've left them behind. I'm like, oh, people who are serving Belgian beers, I'm like, what are you thinking? Like, you know, like you got to serve these other style beers. Although, of course, if they're done right, they're good. Not my favorite style, but done right, of course, there's beers like Hoegaarden, you know, that everybody loved back in the days. I still love it when I have it.
Well, and just, you know, Belgian beers are a touchstone for all craft beers in a lot of ways, and in the sense of yeast-dominant beers, in the sense of sours and other lambic type of inspired beers.
I think that's what's hard
beers.
For a lot of people, too, is that Belgian yeast. It's so prominent.
And so, you know, in some ways, even though it might not be a quote-unquote Belgian-style beer, there's going to be a touchstone, there's going to be some influence in some way coming through. I'm kind of interested in all you guys kind of work for, you know, Avery, Stone, Sierra Nevada now for Kyle, Legendary Beer 30 show here.
Legendary.
And we call ourselves Legendary. Is that all right?
It's your show.
Is that okay?
It's your show.
And, humble, you know, humble, outside legendary. Of the company that you work for, what are some of, like, some, you know, names on what your favorite go-to beer is? I'm just interested in people's kind of honest opinion outside of what they work for. You know, what do you think, Kyle? Outside of Sierra, what's some of your best beer? Let's go around and talk about it.
I think right off the bat, I can think of something very local to me. It actually is about 100 yards away from where I live. Wicked Weed is brand new in North Carolina, and they're 2 years old, a little over 2 years, and they're killing it.
Yeah, Wicked Weed, which we're going to, right?
They have a strong, we'll do all these things. They have a strong sour program, a strong barrel aging program. But even before that, at their original place, which is a full restaurant, full bar, they did that right. And it's they're great. They just continue to make great beer. My favorite is the Freak. Well, I call it the Freak.
Le Freak.
It's not. That's why we have to call it the Freak of Nature. Because Green Flash reached out and said, "Yeah, that's a little too close to ours."
That's really close.
Not a big fan of laws in the beer world, but that happens.
Laws. Don't have any laws.
Lawyers. We don't need lawyers. Let's just drink beer. But they call it the Freak of Nature now. I still got one of the original Freak hats.
Oh, shoot.
Coveted.
It would be worth so much money.
Worn it like three times. No.
Yeah. Tens of dollars.
Tens of dollars.
Yeah. Put some brewer signatures on it.
How about you, Dave? Can you think of anything that Stone doesn't carry?
Outside of our
I mean,
outside of what we brew in our portfolio, I'm going to have to stay local myself, and I'm going to have to say Three Weavers is really brewing some amazing beers.
You love some Three Weavers.
I do. I think those guys, you know, a lot of people tell me, you know, the craft beer industry is getting saturated and all this, and I'm like, well, if you come out of the gate brewing some really amazing beers, people are going to want to drink it, and I think Three Weavers has done that, and I'm a big fan of their beers, so yeah.
You know what I like to shout out to, not a lot of people know about, Highland Park is just killing it out there. Highland Park Brewery.
HPP.
Yeah.
If you haven't paid them a visit, do yourself a favor, go out there.
That is an unfortunate acronym. HPV.
HP.
Oh, you said B.
Whoa.
You said B. I'm sorry.
How about you, Christina?
Easy boy.
If I would have to go with what's still in my fridge, I'm a mountains girl, so I have a sweet spot for Mammoth Brewing.
Mammoth.
And okay. I adore them. And let's say I'm obviously Russian River. And to go across the pond, Leafman's. I'm still such a sucker for the Cuvée Brut and the Guten Bond.
Okay, nice. Leafman's. How about you?
Well, you know, we all like our local ones, and there's a local one close to where I live called Broken Compass outside, or in Breckenridge, that I've really liked, enjoyed recently. They're about 8 months old. Next to those guys, you know... Wicked Weed, what Kyle said. That's one I went to last year, and I spent a lot of hours in that place.
it's hard to leave.
It's hard to leave.
Anytime
it's hard to leave the Wicked Weed.
That soundbite girl over here.
Got to do it again.
The Wicked or the Weed.
Jesus.
I'm sorry. Yeah, you're
wraps you up.
But it's like asking who your favorite child is. It maybe depends on the day, right? You know.
No, of course it does. Your attitude, you know, whatever.
It's what well. We
the
always,
that's it's like asking
what's
Hef
in your
favorite
hand.
Playmate.
What's in your hand? What's your favorite
he's not
beer?
Pick one.
The one I'm sipping on, man. Yes. I'm living in the moment.
That's right. One that's right in front of me.
Blah, 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 blah. All right, Seth.
Do you have a go-to beer outside of Avery?
Well, I'm Firestone Walkers. I'm a huge fan of Firestone Walkers.
They only took like 12 medals.
Yeah, exactly.
So.
Medium-sized brewer of the year. You know,
Again.
But I mean, I think it's just quality and, you know, just it's a go-to if I'm at, you know, a bar and want to drink something different than Avery and know that it's going to be super quality.
Yeah.
But local Comrade Brewing in Denver is brewing some incredible IPAs, a lot of
Comrade.
Just, you know, very hop-forward beers, you know, really light on the malt.
We definitely saw them out there.
Still love those.
Tasty beers.
Sounds
nice.
Good. You
thanks
know.
For that, guys.
What about you?
Me? I just drink
you?
Every fucking thing.
Yeah.
I don't work for nobody, so I just drink everything. Oh, no, but, you know, I am going to this Cascade event tonight, and I do love Cascade.
Yeah.
If you want a really great sour place up in Oregon, it's called Desgardes. I don't know if you've had anything from Desgardes out of Tillamook, Oregon. All-time favorite beers. Some of my all-time favorite beers. Of course, Beechwood, I constantly just talk about
Beechwood. Beechwood is really your favorite.
I talk about it
way
too much.
In Denver, what was your favorite? We only were able to, visit four, five, or six, or seven.
Crooked Stave, easy.
And
easily.
Crooked Stave,
easily.
You were set on going there.
I just love they sour beers really too nice much. Beers. I think I'm a very, when it comes to going to a brewery, of course, you have all these great beers. But when you go to a great brewery that just is like nothing but crazy sours and farmhouse and saisons, That's very impressive to me. Mm-hmm. And I get very excited about those type of things.
So we're talking about White Rascal. We're talking about White Rascal, one silver at GABF.
Baby. Come
on. So now let's set it to the real beer judges on Beer 30 on the classic
make a break.
Four beard system.
I was with authority, too.
I'll give it 3.75 beards.
3.75. Okay, I guess I'll follow that up. Let me get a reminder taster here.
Really delicious. I like this beer. When I go to a bar, you know, this is, I guess, well distributed, I guess you could say.
Thank you.
When
Thanks
to all you fine people. Because when sometimes I go to a bar and it's like, man, what do they got? What am I going to have to drink? What am I going to be forced to drink? And then it's like, oh, thank God they got, I see the A, I see the White Rascal, and I'm more than happy. I'm just excited when, like, that is, you know, because that's out there now, around here at least. I don't know how well, you know, it is around the world. I'm only living right here, but the White Rascal is on tap. At a lot of fucking spots.
You can get it.
And it's delicious.
Thanks, Dave.
Oh, hey. Thanks
for thank you.
No, but isn't thank you. It's a team effort.
It is.
That's,
I love
around.
It. Thank you for drinking it. Thank you for distributing it. Thank you.
And I know a lot of people. I was going to say. I was going to say, I know a lot of, like, why I'm saying that. What I'm trying to get at is I know a lot of people who aren't going out trying to get a craft beer.
Yeah,
and then they drink that, and they're just, like, hooked, and they want to get more. And so it's a good, like, intro beer, plus it adds that extra complexity that is still, like, for mature drinkers. Anyways. 3.75, Dino.
3.75, a fair rating. We kind of agreed it's not my favorite style. Mm-hmm. And if we've had so many good beers tonight, this one is not going to go up. You know, it's not going to beat the other ones that I've had, but it's still a really nice beer. That Belgian yeast, along with the just all these great flavors mixing together, but I'm going to give it a solid 3. I think it's a 3 is where I'm going to land it at.
3 birds.
Let's go to Swirly Game Miller.
Swirly Game Miller Games. Swirly Game Miller Games. What you going to do?
It's not
going to
be another 4 for me. I do love it. I drink another gallon of it. You gave it to me. I'm going to go 3.8. It's not
solid.
My normal style, but I still.
I thought he was gonna hit you with one right there.
I'm not gonna go below 3.8 if it's got one of those A's on the can or bottle.
Oh, that's it. That's all it needs. All right, I understand that.
Setting that precedent right now.
Yeah. A 3.6. Say, throwing it out there.
He's straight going micless on this shit. He's like, I'm gonna go micless. I don't even need to drop the mic because I'm going micless from the beginning.
3.6.
Yeah, I'd have to say this is very true to style. I like the sweet orange. I like the coriander. I like how that goes together. The creaminess that the wheat brings to this beer.
Definitely.
It's just very approachable. I think this is very delicious, and that's why it won the silver medal.
Right.
So I'm going to say a 3.9 on this bad boy right here.
Nice.
This beer, it goes to show you how each person's palate is very, very different. This will win a silver medal here at the GABF, and not everybody's going to love it, though. You know, that's just the way it goes when it comes to drinking good beer.
It's just the way it is.
How about you, Christina?
We see eye to eye, same thing. So I have to say, like, for the style itself, I'll still give it like a solid like 3.75.
Yeah, for the style, for sure.
And I'm proud of us. Silver medal. Hey, first the worst, second the best.
Wow. In your face, whatever that
that's a nice
means.
Spin, isn't it?
Never heard of that one, but yeah.
3.6.
Easy, boom, lay it down, 3.6. I'm leaving the table, dealer. Thank you.
Home.
Seth.
Yeah. You know, you had mentioned Hoegaarden. It's a Hoegaarden G strain. So, traditional. So, you know, when we do win silver medal, it's because it's to the T or trying to get as close to it.
Right. Yeah.
But 3.5 for me.
Yeah. And we did talk to, obviously, a judge, John Palmer, who was a judge at Great American Beer Festival last week. And he's saying more and more, you have to fit that style to a T. Anything that...
Number one thing, he said, is the way they eliminate people.
If
sorry.
The flavors are too high in any different direction, that's going to eliminate you immediately.
He's been judging it for a long time. And what he was saying is nowadays, the first round of elimination is all based off of slightly getting out of the style.
Yeah.
Because in the past, it was dominating the flavors and kind of like making your presence felt, and that kind of dominated the ratings. For a long time now, they've been getting back to true to style type of flavors. And so the easiest way, you got 9, 10, 12 beers in your round, in your first flight lined up. The easiest thing is just slightly out of its style. Yeah.
He's going to eliminate two by aroma immediately. He's going to make another two by flavor, off flavors that come off of those. Another is not going to quite fit the category. And it's really kind of crazy how delicate their palates are. But it just goes to show you why this won, because it fit the category so well.
Yeah.
And then it's obviously delicious.
And why we haven't won a lot of medals, because we don't brew the category.
Right.
You know, this is probably the closest thing that fits into that category, you know, where
we've been brewing
outside of the box beers for so long.
And that's the challenge of competitions in general, is that in one sense, they really elevate the craft, friendly competition. Everyone's trying to do their best. But in another sense, the competitions are always lagging behind what's actually happening in the industry in terms of new styles, new variations, and so in some sense, you know, it's like you're not necessarily getting the best of the best. You're getting of what's the best of that style in according to tradition up to that point.
Yeah, which is that's how it should be.
Which is good. Yeah, it's still a great thing. But at the same time, there's a still, you know, 1, 2, 3 gold, silver, and bronze.
Mm-hmm.
There's still the 5th, 6th, 7th, and 10th beer is delicious beer.
I think Great American Beer Festival, it would be a popular contest, but they should do something where crowd favorite, crowd something, where that's an award too.
That's a good idea.
Because everybody, you know, of course, there's true to style, of course, there's all these things. But there's also stuff that people just really love to drink. Maybe it doesn't even fit a style, but it's a really awesome beer. So I would love to see in the future, a crowd favorite, whatever. Especially with the app,
popular vote.
Especially with the app now and how people take, you know, tasting so seriously, you're going to get some great ratings, some great, real, honest material.
That's true. The infrastructure is already set up for it. Their app already has all the ratings
exactly.
in it. That's perfect.
Well, let me tell you guys, from a distribution level, we are selling the shit out of this beer. It's in our top 10 beers sold, you guys. That's amazing to get into the top 10 because a lot of those are core stone beers.
No, right? That's crazy.
And
you should have said that in the first place.
Well, I'm just waiting for a little break in action here.
Hey, just interrupt us.
No, and I'll just tell you, this is one of our top selling beers out of our portfolio. So if you're talking about people's choice, this is like right there. This is what we're talking in Southern California, our distribution arm. We're selling the shit out of White Rascal.
Oh, yeah.
Just keep it up, gentlemen.
Keep it up.
Ladies, make this shit good. And now winning a medal like that, that really helps us. You know, we got the silver medal winner right here.
It's already top 10 and then it wins the silver, so... that's
awesome.
And you got the new facility. Much more will be produced, right?
Absolutely.
Correctly.
Absolutely.
Much faster. It's funny that each brewery runs into their own problem. You guys ran into not being able to bottle it or can it fast enough. Now new canning line. Is it going to keep up with the production? Or
oh, I hope so. It should.
There was a great saying that was said that it was kind of like we were learning how to ride a tricycle all of our lives, and somebody gave us the keys to the Starship Enterprise and said, "Here you go." So that's kind of what it's been like. Like we're definitely we have the resources. The people that Adam has hired are just incredible. Like I'm so humbled to really be a part of a team that is like so vastly educated in their craft. Like just our lab alone, it's mind-blowing. It makes me wish I paid more attention in science. But no, I think that it's the sky is the limit, not the limit is the sky. So we are we're definitely
explosive statement.
Science,
right?
Science.
Science.
You know what?
We need to have like a Neil deGrasse or a Neil Tice, you know, just kind of sub. But no, we're only going to be making better beer. It's I don't know. It's just
no, we well, have I mean, plenty in stock. I'm going to tell you that right now. They have made
Stern's
sure we are.
Liquor is the place to go for all of your craft beer needs, especially your Avery needs, your specialty.
Get
craft
it going.
Beer.
Yes, we all have Avery needs.
It does sound like maybe even if you had an opinion about this brewery, it's time to maybe give them a new try because
I appreciate that.
You guys have this new facility, and you can see how excited all of you are about it. The new things that have come from it, you've already seen a couple tweaks come from some of these recipes, and you're going to see a lot more, obviously. But it just, you see, maybe it's, you know, maybe it's time to give them another try because with this new facility, I can see it in you guys' eyes. You're like, it's on. It's fucking on.
Yeah, this is the best fucking IPA we've ever made. You know, it's the best White Rascal we've ever made. You know, it's like, it's because of this new facility. I mean, we've always made great beers, but now we're able to use our brains a little bit more than our brawn.
And you know, yeah, sorry.
Well, god damn, this Raja is so
okay. Let's just cut to the chase, guys. Let's cut to the chase. We're basically going to be tasting the newest member of our family.
That's good.
Wait, who just joined us in the studio?
What's happening right now?
who just joined us in the studio?
Fraulein Christina.
I'm part German, yes.
Und Fraulein?
Wie geht's? Welcome to the final hour of the Bier Sorti Show. Hold your breath, Fraulein's.
Just take it from here. With that voice, we're going to go in the green room. All I want to hear from now on is you and that voice.
Tell us about
this is the Raja Double IPA from Avery Brewing. Coming in at 8%. Mm-hmm. Tell us about this beer.
Hot off the press.
Hot off the press.
This beer was released last week.
Okay, freshy.
And I think Christina said earlier, Lilikoi was our newest offering. Nope, this is our newest offering.
Newest offering to add to the year-round batch, but this is maybe the freshest of the fresh.
Absolutely. Correct.
That's what I'm talking about.
Double
and,
yes.
And of course, with the IPAs, we want them fresh.
Bottled this morning,
everybody's getting these fresh, obviously, thanks to distribution.
Thanks, we got this shit going on. Thanks to them getting us to this beer, we get the beer out to you guys. Yeah,
yeah. And we get it straight to Stern's Liquor.
Damn.
Can you be on the show all the time? Like, what's happening?
Anytime,
like,
guys.
You're just like, Stern's Liquor, best beer. I love it. This is a great beer, and it's super hoppy. It's a double IPA, there's no heat coming off this thing. What is the ABV?
8%.
All Australian hops. Vic Secrets, the main hop in it. Galaxies, the dry hop. And boy, is it tasty.
Crikey.
One thing to, there's a little bit of confusion in the name. Maharaja's, our Imperial IPA, you know, that a lot of people know about, and is...
Pat called in about that earlier. Yeah. Pat is Maharaja JBA.
He said the Majadaji or something.
Super popular. Can't keep it on the shelves here in Southern California.
So there is a difference between
Way big difference. So Maharaja is just two completely different beers. This just happens to be the prince to the king of the king Maharaja. So, all Australian, super dry. We wanted to actually try to make as close to a West Coast style IPA as we've ever made.
With that unique Australian hoppy flavor.
For sure. So super, those hoppies, those hops from Australia are very fruit forward.
Fruit Loops, man. Yeah, this is that fruit loopy goodness of that galaxy. Just so big in the aroma and that late edition character.
A little savory.
Dries out really nice. You take a sip.
This beer is going to be huge for us. Especially here. I mean, really. I
agree with you.
It's hot off the press for us, and we're still evaluating it, sitting here tonight talking about it. But this beer has...
I totally agree with you. Having the few sips that I've had, really, really great hop. You talked about the dry bitterness of a double IPA. It's going to have the unique flavors of the New Zealand hops. It finishes with a fresh, nice feeling to it. Those fruit flavors come in at the back end. You know, first you get this dry, bitter, you know, great beer. Then late in it, you get some fruitiness. And then it kind of just kind of burns off into a dry IPA. It's a really nice West Coast style double IPA. Low ball build. But
big drum beat build though.
Bam 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 bam.
Huge.
Sweet. You having fun?
So within the 8% range, like, is this one of those danger beers we talk about sometimes where you just love to sip it, you see it sitting in your fridge, but, you know, four or five of them later, you're talking to Dino late at night about just your, like, dreams, what? And hopes.
Asking him what he's wearing.
I used to be really good at sports, man. I was really good.
Here's the greatest thing about this. First of all, this beer is offered in a four-pack. Oh, yeah. So you get a four-pack offering when it comes to buying the
good.
Cans.
Oh, that's good. Four-pack.
And from the mouths of babes, meaning Adam Avery, we were in this email thread just discussing about some of the press that had gotten released. And, you know, we're all pumped on it because the reception has been really good. And he even said himself that he was getting to a point one night where he thought to himself, and he says in quotation, self, go ahead, drink all four. Like, go ahead, like, it's just a four pack, it's not a six pack. You're not committing to a 12. It's a dangerously good 8% double IPA. But again, there's only four. Kick them home.
Four.
So
you got it.
You'll only be totally fucked up by the end of the four.
I don't know. That's perfect. This guy's got four handle, no problem.
That's perfect.
But this beer is
four is perfect.
It's really nice. This beer is really nice. What was the decision behind cans? Has it always been cans for Avery? Is this something that new age for you guys? What's the decision between doing all these beers in cans?
Well, cans, the wave of the future. Right. I mean, obviously, I think you've probably have spoken on your show about, you know, freshness. Mm-hmm. I mean, the can is the perfect package for that.
There's no question anymore.
And no question at all. I mean, I came from Oscar Blues days back, you know, when we were first starting to can, and so I've always been a huge can advocate. But as the market demands, we're going to continue to put beer in cans. I would imagine, you know, don't record me.
Anything under 9.
Yeah.
Percent. Put them in
that?
A can.
Why that's is that?
Because you can still take it on the river with you.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Take it to the beach.
I like that. Why are you seeing so...
If something is 17%, it deserves a bottle. Right. But... I'd say 9.
Is that true?
I'll take a 9.
Is that true?
I could see in about 10 years you don't have any bottles.
Exactly.
At all.
Is that true? That's what I'm saying.
You know what?
Just as far as a nature standpoint.
You're going to see corks and wine. I don't think you're going to see bottles and beer. Cans are the best packaging, you know, and it's more environmentally friendly. I mean, people are moving in that direction.
The cans are getting
quality
bigger.
Comes in and screw off.
Light
caps.
Do a 32-ounce can all of a sudden.
That's very
light,
important.
Tight, better.
Not a fan of big cans.
Reduce oxidization.
Zero light penetration.
There's
oxygen.
There's just really practical benefits to cans in terms of shipping, distribution, storage, light tie.
But each brewery has their own decision of why they do it. And I wanted to know theirs. And I kind of want to know why others decide bottles. It's really kind of a no-brainer these days that cans keep everything fresher, especially when it comes to IPAs, when all these guys are so picky with how fresh and how everything's delivered.
Before that, it's kind of like what he just said with wine bottles and everything, too. Is there was a, you know, there has been many things written over actually about wine and how, like, the oxygen sucked packages within boxes. Boxed wine basically was the future, but they never caught on beyond the budget market because people still just have this stigma about glass that if I'm paying the money, it better be in a glass.
But that, you know, presentation. You're now getting kegged wine. Because keg's the best packaging.
Mm. Absolutely.
Wine
this,
on tap.
This, to me, is a portable keg, the can.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that. You store it properly, and you can bring it anywhere you can't bring bottles.
Mm-hmm.
Cans are by it the best. And look at the packaging of every single one of these cans.
Oh, it's nice.
They're badass.
Beautiful.
You know, it sticks out. That Raja, that green can, is just like...
fucking buy me.
The whole receptacle.
Take me home right now.
It's not just a label on a glass bottle.
Exactly. That could fall off after some condensation.
The only reason why...
So what's going to happen to home brewers who are trying...
Who are trying to recover bottles. Man, you're left alone in your struggle. But what I was going to disagree about the kegging, of course, kegging, and you can trust a brewery, but when you go out to a bar, when you go out to all these places, it's really hard to trust these tap lines these days, and you really want a great beer, you're paying a lot for these beers, especially when you go out to a bar. I much rather see your beer in a can at a bar than in a keg at a bar, because... I don't trust their tap lines. I don't trust what they do.
You have to trust your distributor.
I'm
a
big concern. I have to graciously disagree.
You guys are on top of it over there.
Every distributor out there cleans their own lines. Yeah. So when you get an account that brings in their beer, we will send a company out there every 2 weeks
to clean
those lines.
Oh, that's a great point. Yeah.
And so every single distributor does that.
So you're saying trust every tap line that
well,
these beers.
If you're going into Joe Billy Bob's Hog Slaughter,
no, which
might
is
want to think
that
twice
is my
about
watering
it.
Hole. That
but
is
Dave,
my
I want to ask that. Is I want to clarify no. that. So if Stone or what other anything Stone distributes and others, you're saying if that's on tap, you can guarantee those lines and those taps are clean.
Yes, I can guarantee that. They'll have a sticker in their cold box and a sticker in their walk-in, wherever it is, and it shows they write the date that they're there. And every single distributor does that. So be confident that these lines are being cleaned, not by them, but by you.
But I have a confession to make, and I'm not going to name the place. But I went to see a concert recently, and I will say that
it's
a regular domestic beer tasted like popcorn.
Yeah, which
tasted like buttery popcorn. Yeah.
Oh, you
diacetyl.
Diacetyl. And
you can
I took
some that slipped by, but
so
for
I
the
feel
most
like
part.
not all are as dedicated as Stone Brewing Company is.
I'll tell you what, especially the craft beer bars.
Yeah. For sure.
That's
what I was thinking.
That's
like a
chef grilling stuff on a dirty grill. They don't.
I'm thinking the difference between a craft beer bar and like a dive bar. It's like sometimes when I go into a dive bar, it's like this is
you'll be
cool,
surprised.
But am I trusting? Like, am I just gonna get that funkified belly after having
a
couple
big name on tap? But they're not keeping.
They're
it clean.
Actually gonna be the best because they don't change their handles, so it's the same distributors cleaning their lines every 2 weeks. Those guys probably have some of the cleaner lines out there, actually. Yeah, guys, I'm telling you, it's all taken care of by all the
distributors.
Nice. That's just maybe...
Nice,
you know,
that's good information. Yes. Where's that's the bing, bing, bing?
Very reassuring.
Bing, bing, bing.
Where you at, Saint? Make some noise.
Knowledge drop.
Big bells.
This is fantastic.
Do you love the Raja, Dino?
The Raja IPA, Dino. Yeah. You want to start off the rating
double
system?
IPA.
I can
double IPA coming in at 8%. What do you think?
I can definitely dig this. Big fan of the category itself. Double IPAs are some of my all-time favorite beers. So to love this beer and to put this up with the rest of the beers that I do love means, to me, it's a great beer. Everything I want from a double IPA, from low malt backbone to a high hop greatness. It's got the aroma you want. It's got the flavor you want. It doesn't leave you too bitter, so it's well-balanced. A great beer at 3.75.
Booyah.
A 3.75.
Dino Flow 3.75.
And that's a tough category for me. I love the double IPA.
Oh, I mean, how many thousands of double IPAs are entering into GABF?
Well,
when
we first started the show, we weren't getting guests on. I was in charge of just bringing the beers, and what we tried, it was like, yeah, we have 4 IPAs.
So we had like 40 or 50 IPA shows in a row.
Yeah, and the next show was like, yeah, like 3 IPAs and a Saison.
Welcome to America.
So, yeah, when I was in charge of the beers, it was a lot different. But a great beer. Who wants to follow me up?
Great beer, just fresh. There's like a big, you know, melon. There's like melon and Fruit Loops and
Fruity Pebbles.
Love this beer. 3.8 beards.
3.8. That's a nice rating.
Maybe even higher. Maybe even higher.
We'll think about it a little
bit. Go ahead. Change
it. Change it.
Okay. 3.89.
Yes.
8.9. So that's 3.9, actually.
We round things up.
I'm so like restrictive, but 3.89.
Kyle's waiting. He's about to shoot out. He's about to explode.
Big four.
Oh,
big old girthy four for you.
Can you do the beard how?
Oh, the Viking.
Clean that mic when I'm done.
Don't worry, we will.
I often use the term, and I don't know that anyone else has ever used the term obnoxious in a beer. And I say obnoxious in the best way.
Because that's why he loves arrogant bastard.
That's arrogant bastard. That made me think this is obnoxious and awesome at the same time. Yeah. And it murders your palate for anything that's coming after it. And that's what I love about a beer. Obviously, you get in the beer industry, you start tasting everything. But what I love and what my bread and butter is and the go-to is the dirty, obnoxious
double
IPA that's well over 8.
Yeah. This one's 8.
But it hits. It hits hard, and it hits with a lot of abundant, obnoxious flavors.
Deliciously.
That's in the dictionary.
That's plural
but
for
dick
obnoxious.
Is spelled D-I-C-K.
So can
obnoxious.
Sure.
Obnoxious.
Yo,
obnoxious.
Obnoxious. Yes.
You could change your name.
I love it so much.
Maharaja, Raja. Just change
obnoxious.
So what's the rating?
4 and 8 more.
Four and eight more. Plus some.
A big old dozen beers for this one.
Hollywood Dave Tardif, what are you thinking about?
I have to tell you, you know, being in this industry as long as I have now, I'm now seeing a wave of different hop varietals come in and out of our industry.
Right.
What's the IBU on this? Do you guys know?
I don't even know.
It's probably 100. Probably 100 plus.
It's 90, Dave. It's 90.
Sitting at a comfortable 90.
90 IBUs. Does that taste like 90 IBUs to you guys? Not at all.
And for a double IPA, that's
not at all, because that's masked by some absolutely delicious. What we're seeing now is the Australian hop character is coming into the market.
Oh yeah.
Everybody's doing this. The Ella, the Vic Secret, the Galaxy, the Topaz, all of those those hop characters are fucking delicious. Avery nailed it with this double IPA, coming in at, I think, an amazing 8%. That is, you know what? I want to get fucked up, but I want to drink 6 of them to get fucked up, not 4. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and
this goes down so easy.
It's a marathon.
This is absolutely delicious, guys. Dang. And I'll tell you, I come from the IPA house.
Yeah.
We sell IPAs in our portfolio.
Oh, I didn't know Stone had IPAs.
Yeah, just a few. Just a few. Not just Stone. I'm telling you, all of our other distributed brands. This is definitely on the top of the list. They nailed it with the Raja. We're going to sell the shit out of this stuff.
Yeah,
too.
You are.
I'll tell you what.
Yeah, you
get
are.
Your hands on it, folks. Yeah. Love it.
Go to Stern's Liquor and Long Beach.
I'm giving this a 4 because it meets that double IPA.
I don't know if you have an actual name for the 4-pack, but I think you should call it the Clover.
I like that.
It's not Irish.
It's not
Irish.
It doesn't have to be.
I like that.
It's lucky.
Irish,
and it's green.
And it's green.
It should grow in fields.
Is there any?
And you accidentally find one.
It should grow in fields.
This was really lucky. I'm going to keep this until I drank it all.
Man, you know, I dare you to follow that, Christina.
Well, I'll tell you what, in parts of South Central, calling it the Ray J.
Ray J
up in here.
I have to say,
I will forever call it the Ray J.
Call it that Ray J.
How often are you in South Central?
Not often enough.
Do you need protection?
What are you going to do, Joe?
I don't know. I'm flying out tomorrow. But if you need to go there tonight, yeah. I've got bearded protection.
Exactly. I'm going to hide behind that beard.
I'm still white, so I'm worthless there.
Okay.
See, when they start charging, his beard goes, woo-hoo, woo-hoo. It just takes
they
over.
They stopped charging.
The beloved Viking call. I am so I so love this radio show. this double IPA again, like we had Lilacoy come out as a new year-round edition. Super stoked on that. And then to release this was about 2 weeks ago. This was my first time actually getting a chance to try it. Some people got a chance to try it prior, and especially at GABF, we did a huge release party. So it was, my heart gushes mm-hmm. with just pride and joy that everything that Adam used to discuss with us in our conceptual meetings really came to life and is in, this is gonna sound gross, but it's in our mouths and it tastes just as good as he said it would.
Yeah.
And it's amazing, you
we
guys.
We go deep.
It's
gross at all to me.
That's normal, deep, right?
We go hard.
It's normal. I mean, it's.
You know where else it is? It's in our bellies.
That's right.
You
know,
so
our guts.
You know I have to say, I'm super proud to say that this gets definitely four huge Viking beards.
Wow.
Four it's huge.
Better
Viking
blow the
beards.
Viking
four
over birds.
Did
that cat just fall out of there? Get that
pussy.
Cat.
Shake it out. Shag, what are you thinking over there?
You know, I'm really proud of this beer too. I mean, it is brand new for us, and we stepped up to the plate in Game 7, and hit a grand slam with this beer, and I feel proud to be a part of it. And so a four.
Yeah, four. I mean, easy four. Easy four.
Shag's first four, right?
Yeah. He's been the Russian judge. He's been the Russian judge the whole night.
99, but
Shag's
first solid four.
How about you, Seth?
So that's saying something.
I mean, it's out of the park. I'm four for sure. Yeah, I mean, the one thing that Christina hinted at was that in the last 3 years, 4 years, Adam has really taken on a more conceptual planning of beer where we're sitting around the table just like this, creating beers for Avery Brewing.
What a great place to be.
It's pretty incredible. Yeah. This beer came from, you know, all of us saying, this is what we need. This is what the styles we need. This is what the flavor profile we need. This is what we want. And he heard us, and this is, you know, a whole brewery plan.
It's really funny to say, but it sounds like 22, 23 years later, you're coming into your own. The company is finally getting where they've dreamed to be. And I can see the excitement from you guys. You can immediately see the change in the beer, and you're going to immediately see a lot more beer produced. So it's good things all around for Avery, it sounds like, right now.
Absolutely.
No doubt.
Absolutely.
I want to thank you guys for bringing so many delicious beers. Everybody rink this last beer?
Yes. This last one came in at number one, the Raja 3.9.
Is that Ray J, baby?
Ray J in the house.
Lilacoy came in at number two at 3.9 beers. And the original 2.9. IPA 2.9. came in at 3.8.
Oh.
And 3.9, sorry. And number four was the Ellie's Brown Ale at 3.79 beards. And number five was White Rascal at 3.7 beards. And number six was, we drank six beers on air?
When we hit the green
Joe's room, Pilsner at 3.69 beards. That means all beers were rated 3.69 or above.
Boom. Like I said, I want to thank all you guys for coming
in.
I think this is
going
to wrap up the latest episode of the Beer 30 show.
Thank you, everybody.
Which happens every single Monday right here on DMZ Radio, 5:30 Pacific Standard Time. Follow you guys on Avery Brewing Co. And Instagram. Same thing on Facebook?
You can find Avery us on Brewing Facebook. Avery Brewing Company. Yeah.
Company.
You can't miss company. The A.
You
can't miss these beers. You'll see them, obviously. Look at these bright colored awesome cans. Every beer, I think, tonight got a killer rating.
Mm-hmm.
Love when that happens.
Hey, we're just really stoked they brought in all those tasty beverages.
Delicious beverages. We got more. We're going to say goodbye till next week. Kyle, what's up, man?
Keep drinking good beer.
Keep drinking. Dave, what's up, man?
Ciao, baby. Thank you so much. Love you guys. Beautiful. Don't go change.
All right. How about you, Christina?
Oh, I just have to say, just go to Stern's Liquor and make sure that you get everything that you've heard about us talking tonight. And yeah,
I'll see you there.
Peace, love, and follow your dreams, man.
Man. Yeah.
Cheers, pros. Thanks, everybody.
Cheers and bros. Mm-hmm.
SoCo in the house.
SoCo in the house. what is it? Drink local, drink craft, brew your own, and maybe try growing your own every once in a while?
Sure. Yeah.
We'll see you next week. DFZradio.com.
It's the Beer 30 Show. Tune in every Monday, 5:30 to 7:30. Booyah.
Yeah. Yeah. We told us.
I'm on E.
Wow, that was so much fun.
I'm on an E. Somebody's king. I'm on an E.